From the Virginia Festival of the Book in Charlottesville, Virginia, a discussion with several authors who have written about unexplained phenomena, including conspiracy theories and supernatural experiences. The conversation lasts about an hour and a half.
Well, looks like this is it. Can you all hear me? Everybody hear me? Let me just begin by getting a feel for where everyone is in the audience. Is there anybody here who can claim to have seen a UFO? Hands? A couple? Is there anyone here who can claim to have seen ghosts or anything like that? Out-of-body experiences? A couple? Is there anybody here who belongs to a cult? Yeah, Episcopal Church counts, actually. Is there anybody here who is packing right now? Well, I guess we can proceed then. Yeah. Today's subject, ostensibly, is American lunacies, and without being too flip about what's going on in the culture, what I'd like to do with the panel is examine, take the temperature, basically, of the zeitgeist, find out what's going on at the end of the millennium. Today's panelists include Joel Achenbach, who's a Washington Post columnist for the Washington Post daily online paper. His books include Why Things Are and Captured by Aliens. Next, we have Michael Shermer, who's the editor of Skeptic Magazine. He's the author of Why People Believe Weird Things and How We Believe. And on my right, we have Jody Dean, who's an associate professor at Hobart and Williams College. Have I got that right? I'm sorry, Hobart and William Smith College, and her book is Aliens in America. On the far right is Alex Hurd, the executive editor of Wired Magazine, whose book is Apocalypse Pretty Soon.
Not too late.
It's never too late for an apocalypse, I guess. What I'd like to do is just ask everybody generally, in the broadest possible brushstrokes, to paint in where they think we are now compared to, let's say, the 1960s. Is this a kind of quiet upheaval going on with all the cults, or is this something totally new? Alex, what's your take on that?
Okay, well, I don't have any data on this. It's all just based on my reporting and reading I did. I think that there obviously was a lot of millennial and apocalyptic activity around the turn of the millennium, but one of the things is there always has been. I think the media noticed it more, and they will also tend to think that it's all going away because most of the media attention was on Y2K, and that fizzled, and most of those people have gone away, but a lot of them, you'll find over the years, if you keep up with this, will shift their energies about that to something else. And one of the new things, there's a bestseller by Art Bell called The Coming Age of Global Superstorms. And that's going to capture a lot of those people because he's saying that global warming and environmental change is going to bring a new kind of chaos and just storms that kill millions of people. So I think we're in a pretty active period and always will be, you know.
I understand Virginia, particularly, this is something we can all be proud of here. Virginia has quite a few cults going. Is that?
Yeah, although I first thing I'd do is I don't really talk about cults much, except in the rare cases where that term applies. Most of these groups are political or religious groups. They just happen to be on the fringe. And cult is a pretty loaded term that doesn't really go for most of these people. But yeah, Virginia has everything. UFO people. There's a famous place called the Monroe Institute few miles from here where they teach you to have out-of-body experiences, which at first glance doesn't seem millennial, but if you read the doctrines behind it, it is a very revelatory thing that has a long view attached to it.
Mm-hmm. Joel, what's your take on where the zeitgeist is right now?
Well, there's been a big change since the 1960s, really. I'm glad you brought that up because it used to be that UFOs were very much of a hardware issue. People saw stuff in the skies they didn't understand. They saw, you know, lights or at least objects moving around in a strange way. And since then, it's become a much more personal thing, more of a software type issue in which people have these direct experiences. For that reason, I try not to convert people to my own personal belief about aliens, which basically is that if I were to wake up one morning and find, you know, three little bald-headed skinny creatures with three fingers each chewing on my foot, I still wouldn't believe in aliens. But I try not to convert people because I know how personal the belief is to them. And for example, in my book kind of goes all over the place. I spend time talking to Carl Sagan and time talking to the people at NASA. But I also spend some time in UFO country, and a couple of the characters are people who believe that they themselves are aliens, that they think they're from the Pleiades, or that their spirit is from space. And this makes perfect sense to them, and it kind of explains why in their life they felt a little out of sorts, like they didn't really belong here on Earth, a little alienated, so to speak. And so in talking to them, at one point was hypnotized in a hotel room trying to recover the memory of my own alien abduction, but I totally failed at it. I couldn't quite picture what happened. But that doesn't actually prove that I wasn't abducted, because you see, that's how they work. You know, they're able to erase the memory of the abduction, so it doesn't prove anything.
Michael, how do you see all this? Does it relate to religion in some way?
Joel, they don't have three fingers, they have four. So just made a correction there. Actually, on Wednesday, I was on a TV show, on just a Southern California TV show, which is where I'm from. And by the way, parenthetically, Virginia is not the hotbed of weirdness. Southern California is. You guys have nothing on us. We own that category. Anyway, the show was ostensibly on psychics and haunted houses, that sort of thing. But while I was waiting in the green room, there was a couple of women astrologers there talking about crop circles. And I said, well, you know, what do you think they are? And she said, well, you know, the aliens have, you know, left these circles in these crops. So then I launched into this little routine I do that's actually usually pretty funny when I do it at Caltech for the skeptics. And it's like, you know, the chances of an extraterrestrial intelligence somehow mastering all the problems to conquer interstellar space travel and all the enormous technological advances they'd have to achieve to get here, and let alone even finding this obscure planet, what it would cost for them, and what are the chances they're going to do all that and just leave graffiti in Farmer Bob's field in Pucker Brush, Kansas? I mean, what is the likelihood of this? Then I do this whole thing about how, you know, we could just imagine, you know, at the planet Vega, and at the Senate hearings about about what actually happened here, about the crop circles and stuff. And, you know, so let me get this straight, Senator Zorg. You know, you spent 50 quazillion zlotys in order to find this planet, and the best you could do is leave graffiti, and the upheaval and the people that would be fired about this. And without missing a beat and not even blinking, this woman says, they don't use money on Vega. And honestly, she said, I wouldn't make this up. Some stuff I just make up, but this I didn't. And I said, I didn't know what to say. I said, you know, I just made that up. And she said, no. And the Pleiadians, they don't have government. And, you know, they're way beyond money and government and possessions. And, you know, imagine no possessions. I did this whole thing. I wonder if you can. And she didn't get it, you know. She didn't just, you know. Anyway, so... And that's just a little sampling of what we do at Skeptic. We do try to take a pulse on this to try to keep track of this sort of thing. It is different from religion, certainly. Mainstream religions are not cults. You know, we need to use our language carefully, I think. Cult has become such a broadly used epithet in our culture. It's really meant to be an insulting sort of thing. And so I wouldn't call the U.S. Army and the Catholic Church and things like that cults. But when they're particularly centered on a single individual, in which people are detached from their family members and reference groups, things like that, then it becomes cult-like, that sort of thing. And do I think this is actually somehow getting worse than it used to be? It's hard to say. From a social scientist, to answer the question properly, would need to operationally define what you mean by pseudoscience or superstitions or cults, or you'd have to pick a particular subject, and then you need to define how you're going to measure the change. I mean, is it number of movies about cult-like or psychic phenomena like The Sixth Sense? Is it number of films, number of books, number of magazine articles, column inches in newspapers? And what's your time frame, 90s compared to the 80s, compared to the 60s, compared to 1900, compared to 1500? I suspect it's not as bad as it was, say, in 1500, if you were just talking about how superstitious the average guy in the street is. Hopefully, since we live in the age of science, we've made some progress. But it is surprising, since we live in the age of science, that two-thirds of Americans believe in psychic power, half believe in UFOs, the aliens are here, and that sort of thing. It is surprising, considering that we do live in such an advanced age.
Mm-hmm. And what's your take, Jody?
I think the biggest change since the 60s is media and technology. And that one of the things that has happened to us is that a lot of stories that might have been known only to small subgroups are now known to everybody. So what's interesting is not that Americans believe weird stuff. I mean, folks have always believed weird stuff. What's really interesting is why everybody else cares, right? Why does the Washington Post care about bizarre belief systems, right? And I think that the reason people care is that we're fascinated with those folks who are willing to doubt mainstream reality. And the reason we're fascinated by those folks willing to doubt mainstream reality is that most of us do. And the reason most of us do is it's so complicated now. Right? All of the technology makes it so complicated, and the stakes are very high. Right? One thing goes wrong with genetic engineering, and we're history. One thing goes wrong with nuclear power, we're gone. So the stakes are very, very high. And to say that now science can save us, that strikes me as nuts, right? Science can go just as far the other way. So when we think about folks who believe in weird stuff, I think we're attracted to them because they're willing to take that step that most of us take in tiny little ways.
Alex, do you think that the people you met and interviewed were taking a step away from the technological drive of society?
Yeah, definitely. It's not just science. I talked about it. Most of these people are reacting against the way the world is right now. So it's a science, you know, big government, fairly liberal democracy, various aspects of the way current reality is, they just don't want any part of it. Either the world's too sinful, or sometimes it's people who are left out, too. A lot of the people, I have a lot of pseudoscientists in the book, and they think they are scientists, and they're not. They're crackpots. You know, they're people who are trying to invent perpetual motion machines, or think that Space Brothers are landing next year at a precise day. It's because, you know, they're usually not people who had a chance to get a PhD. They either didn't have the money or they didn't have the intellect, but they still have these urges to do these things. And this is sort of their way of saying, I don't accept that science has all the answers and I can only consume it. I want to produce something. And so it's an active thing in that way.
Yeah, and it raises a question, too, of whether or not we can all agree that some things are real and some things are imaginary. I mean, do we get to the position where science is simply somebody's opinion, where facts are simply a prejudice? Joel, what's your take on that?
I think science is one of the great heroic feats of the human species, in that, you know, I'm not a scientist, I'm a newspaper reporter, but, you know, people gave their lives to find out the truth about the world we live in. You know, the fact to be able to say that the Earth goes around the sun and not vice versa, you know, got Galileo and Giordano Bruno in a lot of trouble. You know, this is something that it kind of amazes me, actually, that so many people just sort of, I don't want to say seem unappreciative, but just sort of absorb all the technology and science that makes that enters our daily lives, takes it for granted, and then goes off and says, well, science is narrow-minded. I don't actually think science is narrow-minded. I think science has repeatedly given us some mind-boggling models of reality, ranging from, you know, the expanding universe. I mean, the whole universe is expanding. I mean, that's not something that necessarily is commonsensical, to, you know, the existence of dinosaurs, you know, that millions of years ago, these giant reptiles were pounding around the planet. I mean, that is an amazing idea. You know, tectonic drift. I mean, the fact that entire continents can float on the surface of the planet and move around is, again, it's a very challenging idea that has been borne out over time. And so it kind of bums me out that people think science is this sort of narrow view of reality, when I look at science as being the kind of combined effort of thousands and thousands of men and women over a very long period of time, trying to find out well, what is the sort of reality behind the world as we perceive it?
Michael, is it becoming simply a matter of faith over proof?
Well, I'm a pretty pro-science guy, so I concur with Joel on a lot of that. On the other hand, the examples that you gave were where the demarcations are pretty clear between what's sense and nonsense, and we've got confirmation and almost total agreement amongst most scientists on a lot of these things. When you get into the social sciences, it's a lot fuzzier, and those fuzzy sets have big fuzzy boundaries between the sense and the nonsense, and it's harder to say, you know. So a lot of issues of Skeptic magazine we devote to these social issues because that's where the action is for me. It's not clear. We did a whole issue on race and IQ when the bell curve came out. Boy, you talk about lack of agreement and egos and people getting upset. The data do not just speak for themselves. They are definitely filtered through theories, and particularly in the social sciences, science is very much theory-driven. And so we have to be cautious about some of those social claims. And of course, even in biology, where we know evolution's a fact, it's not in Kansas and some other places in America. And it's really, really definitely an American phenomenon that evolution is even challenged. Nowhere else in the world, except a little pocket in Australia, do people even doubt that evolution happened. They may argue about how it happened and punctuated equilibrium and gradualism, these sorts of things. But that tells us that there's a cultural element there involved in science. And as for faith, in how we believe, I really make the argument that these are two separate things, reason and faith, or science and religion, mainly because the problem, if you're religious, with trying to prove your tenets of faith is that you're always chasing science. You're always one step behind, wondering where it's going. And what did they discover today? Oh, no, they found another black hole. Oh, dear. Now, let's see. This is not in Genesis. Now, how am I going to reconcile this with my religion? You know, if you're constantly thinking, I got to somehow prove that my religion is true, then you're going to be stuck with the ever-changing nature of science and having to change your religious tenets to go along with that. And I think that's the biggest argument from the religious side for why you shouldn't be trying to do science when it's really just religion.
Jody, do you think that some of the scientific certainties that we hold very closely now, in 100, 200 years, might look like bloodletting to people of the future?
I actually think that they're scientific things that we think we're certain about that we're actually not. For example, salt. I don't know if anybody remembers, but about 2 years ago, I think it was Scientific American, came out with all the debate about salt. Health people and medical scientists disagree about whether salt is bad for us or not. If people follow diets as they're given to the American public, there's a big debate about whether or not you should eat a lot of protein or eat a lot of carbohydrates. I mean, these are things that we're taught are basic science that the scientists seem to know. But then once you start digging a little bit, we realize that there's major disagreement. So how mad cow disease is transmitted, that's not clear. There's a huge debate about that. So I actually think that it's important to remember that what seems to be a clear-cut set of facts is not clear-cut at all. The other thing I want to add is that it's weird how people who want to give a strong defense of science against, you know, pseudoscience want to say, oh, science has amazing ideas and is, you know, not just common sense. But then they turn around and say, oh, those UFO people, they don't have common sense and they've got American ideas. I mean, not American, I'm sorry, they've got amazing wild ideas. So I start to worry that no matter how it's sliced, the people who are doing wild stuff always end up getting trashed, right? Either they've got too much common sense because science has amazing ideas, or they've got too amazing ideas because science has the monopoly on common sense. Finally, on whether or not people who do UFO stuff or so-called fringe stuff are really on the fringes, or whether or not they're really people who are left out, I got into this field because of Harvard professor John Mack's work, because he believes that the abductees are telling the truth. I was shocked that someone in the university of the country would go that far. So I'm not even sure enough to say that people with wild, you know, so-called fringe ideas are really on the fringe at all.
Well, John Mack is certainly the unnamed elephant in the room, in a lot of respects. Alex, let me ask you, you touched upon something earlier. How much of the millennial, how many of the millennial events do you think are a direct result of the assignment desk's obsession with them? Would people really care? Would it be the tree falling in the forest and nobody would really bother?
No, I think there's steady interest, but they didn't care. I used to write about this stuff in the late 80s, and I had trouble selling my story ideas because people would say, you know, that's fascinating, but what's the hook? And there isn't a hook. You know, the fact that there are people, you know, Christians who believe the world will end as described in Revelation, there's not always a clear reason to get into it. So, but I do think, you know, we definitely had a surge of interest. The other thing I noticed, I got a lot of calls from TV reporters who are the laziest people in the world. And they were like, we got to do a piece on millennial groups. Can you give me five names? And I want people who are like bunkering down. You know, they're probably going to kill themselves. And so there's always this assumption that it's dangerous, negative, that the year 2000 and the midnight on January 1st was a major flashpoint. Mm-hmm. All that can be true, but it's usually not true. And I kept saying, most of these people, when their thing doesn't happen, they've already built in a clause to their beliefs that will allow them to go on. Now, with Y2K, that was impossible. It's one of the few times. But with Earth changes, which is a very widespread belief that the planet is trying to kill us by producing more natural disasters, they used to talk about 98 as being the trigger year when you could not mistake that this was happening. And then it was a bad weather year, but it wasn't like they thought. So they switched and said, you know, the spirits say that 2012, we've been given an extension.
Kind of like a great student loan program.
Yeah.
Joel, speaking of escape clauses, you mentioned Carl Sagan shifting his frontier further and further away. For example, the moon around Mars being possibly a man-made construct. What was your experience with the escape clause phenomenon?
Well, Sagan said at one point in the 60s, and for many years he entertained the idea that Phobos, one of the moons of Mars, might be a hollow object. That is a construction of intelligent civilization. And Sagan is sort of the hero of my book because he entertains these wild ideas, but he has the ability at the last minute to sort of pull back and say, but what do we really know? And he was willing, up until really his deathbed, to say that even though he had spent his whole life trying to find extraterrestrial life, even though he wanted to know the truth about life beyond Earth, he knew that he had not found it. It takes a lot of courage to say, I don't know, in a situation like this, because typically in this topic, the alien topic, people say, oh, I know. I know exactly what the reality is. And they try to prove it to you. What Jody said before, I want to address that about, are scientists good and UFO true believers bad? You weren't making it that simple, but I try to show in my book that scientists are just, in many ways, very much like everyone else in that they have belief systems that they pursue, and sometimes it colors the way they view the world. I mean, Sagan thought there were 1 million civilizations in this galaxy at this moment, 1 million other intelligent civilizations. And that he had no data to support that. I mean, he had an estimate that he made based on this thing called the Drake equation. But you find, in fact, throughout the scientific world, a lot of very wild ideas that are not necessarily true. In fact, in my book, there's a chapter on Charlottesville, because I came here for a meeting of the Society for Scientific Exploration, where all kinds of, unusual ideas about, past life recall and near-death experiences are entertained. And so I try to show that it's not like, there's a divide between, the hard scientists and then the soft-minded cultural believers.
Excuse me, Michael. One thing I'm curious about is this whole fuzzy zone, the shift between knowing something and being skeptical. And in the past, we might be skeptical in order to drive ourselves toward knowing something really, really well. Do you find that there's no room for skepticism among certain believers? And do you find yourself a very unwelcome guest in a lot of venues?
Yes.
Moving on.
Let me just tell you a little story, actually, that I recount in Why People Believe Weird Things, and that is in August of 1983, I was abducted by aliens. It's true. It actually happened, or something happened. And so the story goes like this, and this, I'm not making this up either. I was traveling down a lonely rural highway in Nebraska, and isn't that always where these things happen, lonely rural highways? But I was, and it was about 3 a.m., and a large craft with bright lights came up over my left shoulder and stopped me, and they took me into the craft where I lost 90 minutes of time. Abductees call this missing time. They write books about missing time. And the next thing I knew, I was like out of the craft and traveling back down the road. And I distinctly remember the aliens, what they looked like. They looked just like people. In fact, they looked just like people that I knew. But I knew that they were aliens because they had stiff little fingers. And I could see that. And that was my clue that I knew that they knew. But they didn't know that I knew that they were aliens. So I was going along with this whole thing. Knowing that I knew, but that they didn't know, and this went on and on. Anyway, and I used to tell this story when I was teaching a psych course on, when I get to the part on schizophrenia, where schizophrenics hear voices. You know, they really hear the voices. The experiences are very real for them, and so I will tell that story because it's a very real experience for me. Now I tell the story in the context of aliens, because when I was telling the story back in the early 80s, the stuff wasn't big. Now it's huge, and everybody's being abducted by aliens. In my case, the explanation is that traveling down the lonely rural highway, I was actually on a bicycle, in the middle of a transcontinental bike race called Race Across America that I founded and raced in a number of times. And the race has rules in which you don't stop. It's from West Coast to East Coast. First one there wins. Everybody takes the same route. And so there's no sleep. Or you can sleep if you want, but then you fall behind. So I had gone 83 hours without sleep and ridden 1,250 miles without stopping, except for a few potty breaks in the motorhome that always follows behind you at night with bright white lights, with a support crew that looks just like people you know. And over the years, I've done informal studies with the various riders, and when I quit racing the race, and I'd still go along and study the sleep patterns of the riders, and everybody was hallucinating like crazy in the early years because they didn't figure out the sleep pattern stuff. So the 90 minutes of missing time, by the way, I was weaving down the road at about 5 miles an hour, hallucinating away, and my crew stopped me and put me in for a 90-minute sleep break, which is a nice cycle because you can get down to the deep and back up to the light sleep and then back going again, and you'd be amazed what you can do in 90 minutes of sleep. But that's the missing time. And the stiff little finger is where it's really the crux of the story is that when I was a kid, there was a story, a TV show on CBS starring Roy Thinnis. I just saw him on X-Files a few months ago, in fact. Yeah. And the aliens were taking over the planet, and they looked just like humans. And again, one of these stories, you know, somehow they've mastered interstellar space travel, and they could take over DNA and replicate somebody's body, but they couldn't bend their fingers. Anyway, so they had to wear gloves and go through all these contrivances so that people would notice the stiff little fingers, but I noticed. So there, how odd that, you know, 20 years after the fact, deep in the recesses of my memory, comes this television theme story, this sci-fi story that gets inculcated into a dream state and a hallucination triggered by the stress of physical exhaustion and mental exhaustion from sleep deprivation. Now, I don't claim abductees have been sleep deprived. I don't know what's going on with them. They had a bad pork chop the night before, or they're just fantasy prone. But when they tell you over and over and over that the abduction happened late at night at 3 a.m. when I was in my bed asleep, it seems like a more obvious hypothesis than abduction is sleep deprivation or a sleep hallucination or a lucid dream or something like that. And so, and in that case, I think, back to the what is science discussion, I think we can actually say in some instances whether things are true or not. And in any case, you certainly behaviorally act as if they're true or not. We make those decisions, even if intellectually we qualify and say, well, maybe, perhaps, this kind of thing. Behaviorally, no one's an agnostic. And Sunday morning, you get up, tomorrow morning, you're either going to church or you're staying home to watch football or whatever's on. And so you make that decision. And for me, the decision is made that aliens are not coming here. They are not here. And I conceivably changed my mind, but I really need to see one of those, you know, probe instruments that they, you know, I just asked these guys, bring home an ashtray, something from the spacecraft, and they never do.
We have a few of those in the lobby afterwards.
The ashtrays or the probes?
Well, it depends on how you want to use an ashtray, I guess. Jody, Michael just mentioned the TV show The Invaders, and does anybody in here remember the TV show The Invaders? It's a great show, and one of the things it did was make you very, very paranoid. That everybody around you was somehow, you know, an alien. To what extent does the alien phenomenon, do you think, intersect with our natural homegrown paranoia growing up out of the conspiracy to kill Kennedy and all the other conspiracies we've dealt with in the culture?
I think paranoia is part of being an American. The Declaration of Independence is a paranoid document, right? It has not, in addition to the wonderful preamble, right, the rest of it's a list of grievances that are designed to show that the king was involved in a conspiracy against the colonists. So since then, it's part of being an American, is to be paranoid. And now with cameras everywhere, I mean, even in this room, how are we not to be a little bit paranoid? I actually wanted to address Michael and Joel's point. I think a lot of abductees would like the kind of certainty of reality that Michael describes. And in fact, I think that abductees are a lot more skeptical than either one of them think that they are, and I probably think that they're more skeptical than they are. If Carl Sagan is the hero of Joel's book, I guess Bud Hopkins is probably the hero of mine. He's an abduction researcher and an artist in New York. And he has a wonderful little saying that he's more skeptical than Carl Sagan because he's willing to question everyday reality. And that's one of the things that I found in my research with abductees is that they don't believe anything for sure. They're not 100% convinced about UFOs or aliens or what they've been through. All they know is that they've experienced something that they absolutely can't explain and that they can't understand and that they're not getting very much support for. So I think it's important to think about, you know, what does it actually mean to be skeptical and how far can one go? Because I think that most abductees go really, really far, and in their willingness to question everyday reality, they go a lot further than, you know, some so-called skeptics.
And Alex, just to pick up on this note of skepticism and believing, to what extent do you think the people really are skeptical, and to what extent do you think they're enabled by great scientists, perhaps someone like John Mack?
Wait, which people?
People who have been abducted by aliens. I mean, do they really examine this, or are some of these events repressed memories or planted?
I don't know much about abductees nearly as much as these guys, so I shouldn't wander down that path. But I do think, just talking about skepticism, one of the things about these beliefs is it's not a choice with most people. Mm-hmm. It's just there. And I often come to a point where I try to explain why somebody believes something. And you can't ultimately explain it, and they can't either, because if you ask them, you know, why do you believe this? And you're asking them to step aside and look at themselves as a specimen, you know? And they go, well, it's not a belief, it's the truth. And so it's not something they can do anything about, and most of them are, you know, pursue these beliefs without hurting anyone. There are major exceptions to that. And what I like in a skeptic, Shermer here, is operates the way I think they should. He reads their material. He says, I disagree with all of this, and here are my counter arguments. There's a strain of skepticism, though, that goes farther than that, almost puritanically saying, it is bad by definition that anybody believes these things, and we have to figure out something to do about it beyond providing counter arguments. And, you know, we don't do that in this country. We don't have a police state saying you can't believe these things. But there are places where it is like that. And I defend people's right to have goofball ideas, you know.
Speaking of condemning people's ideas and all the rest, which sounds like almost a reactionary Christian sort of thing, perhaps not to diss the Christians too much, because they were once there themselves. But how much of this is an interface between superstition and religion?
I'm not sure I can address that in great depth. I mean, I, in fact, in reporting this book, felt kind of challenged in my inability to really appreciate the origins of religion, the origins of belief. I realized when I went into this book, I wanted to find out, well, what is the truth about life beyond Earth? I mean, my book is actually, I mean, two-thirds of it is about what you'd say is science. It's about the space program. It's about the SETI search for radio signals. Only the middle part is the UFO stuff. And I, in fact, kind of, you know, go down that road and then throw up my hands and say, there's no information here. I mean, the bad thing about the aliens that come and abduct people is they don't actually tell you anything about themselves. Aliens have no information, they have no history. I mean, it'd be so great if they would say, well, here's the, you know, the last 1,000 years of history of our civilization in the Pleiades, but they don't give that. I mean, they're very mysterious, slippery creatures who just take little, you know, segments of your DNA and then run away, you know, and it's, so as far as trying to find the truth about life beyond Earth, I find that the UFO hypothesis has a deficit of information and is fundamentally not that interesting. I mean, you know, the problem with that whole scenario, in my opinion, is that it's not true. I mean, the aliens are not here. That is my take on it. Now, I'm just a newspaper reporter, so no one should believe what I say about that. But for me, trying to find out, you know, what is the biology of the universe? I mean, we're in this amazing moment right now in which, thanks to these incredible telescopes we have, we know, or we have the information to believe that we live in this unbelievably huge universe in which the Earth is a tiny little world. I mean, just one little planet around one star that's maybe among 100 billion stars in one galaxy among 50 billion galaxies. So this sort of challenges us to figure out, you know, what's going on here? What does that mean? And we know the structure of that universe fairly well. I mean, we have all this data coming in about what's out there structurally, the physics of the universe. What do we know about the biology of the universe? What do we know about life beyond Earth? And the truth is, we don't really know anything at all. Right now, we don't have any information about a single microbe from beyond this planet, except for the assertion by this one team of NASA scientists that they found some microbes in that meteorite from Mars. That claim, as I show in the book, is very questionable. Most people in that field, you know, who are fellow meteoriticists, people who study this stuff, say they don't got the goods on that claim. We don't, at the moment, know of any liquid water beyond this planet. So before we find, you know, intelligent aliens, and before we find even a microbe of life out there, it'd be nice to find some, just, you know, some liquid water. So that's where we're at right now. And to me, it's sort of an amazing puzzle, because we may be in this sort of special moment in human history before the discovery of the truth about the biology of the universe. Unfortunately, you know, you can go to scientists and try to get information, and it's like, you know, it can be really difficult to get any real facts out of them. But definitely in the UFO world, you find it even harder to find anything that you could really say, this feels like the truth.
Michael, from the UFO believers' point of view, or the experiencers, as they call themselves, there are certain things that are central to their beliefs, the missing time, as you mentioned, the lonely Nebraska highway. Are there any pieties that are particular to the scientific mindset or to being a skeptic, to the skeptical mindset, that are themselves questionable, possibly?
No.
I'm glad we cleared this up.
We have certainty. Well, now look, this is the core of the debate here that Jody has identified, and I think the terms of the debate, this side and that side. There's an essential tension in science that exists in all of us, that tension between orthodoxy and change, between being open-minded enough to accept radical new ideas, but not so open-minded that your brains fall out. And where do you draw that line? How do I know? I mean, I don't want to be a grumpy old skeptic that misses out on the great new discovery of the 21st century. I don't want to be that guy. But so much of what I encounter is just utter bunk that it seems to pay to be conservative. And science really is conservative in that regard. It can't afford not to be. There's only so much time and resources and money to run around exploring and testing a lot of these claims. My buddies at Caltech They don't have time to deal with all these perpetual motion machines and free energy people. They just have them call me. And essentially, that's what we do at Skeptic, is we do that. But there are not that many people doing that, and most mainstream scientists don't want to be bothered, so they come off as real elitists and snobs and closed-minded, and you're just not open. They're plenty open-minded about all kinds of things, and science is very open to radical new ideas. Witness all the revolutions that have occurred in the history of science. But in the alien example, I think, and Sagan is such a good example of somebody who treaded that fine line, that tension between being fairly open-minded, and when he first started off, he was pretty radical. I mean, it really hurt him. He couldn't get tenure at Harvard. He never got elected to the National Academy of Science, and those probably because he stepped over that boundary. But he never steps too far beyond that boundary. He would not go so far as to accept the alien abduction scenarios and UFOs as actually proof of people visiting here, yet he was speculating on Phobos as an artificial satellite, these sorts of things, which got him in plenty of trouble with the more conservative establishment. So there's no answer to the question in you and me and each of us when we think about any given claim, where am I going to fall on that line? It's a tough call. And I think we do decide. I think all these guys decide. Hopkins, Mack, me, we all have decided. And I think it'd be disingenuous to pretend otherwise, that I'm just open-minded. I don't think I'm really open-minded on the subject. I don't think Hopkins or Mack is either. They'll say that in an interview on television because it sounds good. Oh, I'm open-minded. I'm not sure what it is. You know, could be this, could be that. Yeah, but really, really, they've decided. They don't accept my scenario that it's a psychosocial phenomenon or brain hallucination. They really don't accept it. They really think something else is going on. And I think I've decided it isn't. And I think if we're going to be honest with ourselves, we do make a decision at some point, and then we go down that road. And it's hard to back off, particularly when you write a book about it or something. It's really hard to back off.
We're hearing some names here that maybe not everybody's familiar with. Can you tell us a little bit, Jody, about John Mack and Bud Hopkins?
Sure. John Mack, as I've mentioned, is a professor at Harvard. He's a Pulitzer Prize winner for a biography of Lawrence of Arabia. And he has two books. The most recent is Passport to the Cosmos. And in that one, he's making connections between the abduction experience and shamanism all over the world. This was a huge study that he received funding for, to go and talk to a shaman in the rainforest and in various different countries. And his other book, I think it's just called Abduction, is a series of case studies of his work with abductees. Bud Hopkins is, for many people credit Bud Hopkins with really getting the abduction issue out in front of the mainstream public, along with Whitley Strieber. And Hopkins has a number of books where he describes his research on abduction and his work with specific abductees. And he has a Intruders Foundation in New York that has a support group for abductees, as does Mack. Mack also has a support group where abductees can come in and talk about their experiences.
Now, didn't John Mack run into some trouble at Harvard because of allegations that he had brainwashed some of his patients?
Well, I think that's a little extreme. He almost lost his tenure, and he had to fight a very expensive legal battle to keep his tenure because the rest of the faculty in psychiatry thought that he had gone too far. But he won. There was a set of allegations of someone it was all published in
Time. Wouldn't there have been somebody who pretended to
be one of
his
patients?
Yeah, a woman
who pretended to be an abductee and said wild things like, and then I was abducted and Khrushchev and Kennedy were there, and Mack apparently is going, yeah, really, what else? And she was making it all up, and he was all believing it. And later she came out and said she made it up. And weirdly, he came out and said, oh, I think it was true, she's just in denial now, which was not a great answer, especially for people like me who are trying to make them not look so crazy. That's Mack.
Have you found a discernible lack of skepticism on their part? I mean, for example, we could say from the scientific point of view that they're always trying to disprove each other, and that's what keeps them on their toes. Mm-hmm. But is it generally the case, or possibly the case, that in the alien community or the paranoid community, anything goes and skepticism is frowned upon?
I don't think so. I had breakfast at Bud Hopkins last year, and what was so wild to me is Hopkins and some of his friends were all there trashing the satanic child abuse people. I mean, they're like, oh, I can't believe anybody would ever believe this. Oh, they're crazy false memory people. What, they're lunatics? Have you read their stuff? It's totally unscientific. So they were really skeptical about the satanic child abuse cult aspects of a belief system.
And that came from a professor at the University of Chicago, didn't it?
I think a lot of
same sort of standard of high education, I guess. Alex, is a lot of this just a way of living for people, that they just retreat from the world, or are they looking for some kind of nirvana also?
Well, it completely varies. It can be everything. Some of these things are like going to church on Sunday. That's the level of involvement. Some of them are like cults where people change their lives and disappear. The gray area in between is the most common, and you find that most people work these beliefs into pretty ordinary lives, or it's sounds like a cult, but it's really just a church. One of my groups is the Unarius Academy of Science, which is a UFO group in San Diego, near San Diego. They believe Space Brothers are landing next year, and they will herald in a new age. It's a small group, and the people volunteer, and they pay a little money, you know, every week. It's not, but it's like tithing. It's not like a cult offering. And these are people who, most of them seem to have some kind of problem in their background. A lot of times it was drugs, but this is their little church. And that's what I found to be usually the case. It's more of a hobby than like all-consuming thing that takes you out of the mainstream. Another guy, probably some people have heard of around here, Dr. Stephen Greer, who's an MD who has an organization called CSETI, and it's the Center for the Study of Extraterrestrial Intelligence, and he trains people to go out at night and literally try to flag UFOs to land on them. And he's utterly serious, and it's all tied into this grandiose view of the way the future is going to change once this happens and once he makes this contact. But the guy goes to work at an emergency room every day, or he used to. Mm-hmm. So that's one of the fascinating things. He has this, I think, insane belief and practice, but then he's got this other channel where he's utterly irrational and able to perform. Mm-hmm. And I saw that again and again.
Yeah, let me ask. So far we're talking about doctors and scientists and people who are ostensibly very well educated and seem very competent in their regular lives. To what extent is this a function of class or income? Is this just a form of intellectual tennis club membership? I mean, does it spread around the world? For example, why haven't aliens landed in New Delhi?
It does seem that there are entire countries where the aliens do not visit for some reason. I have a question, for Alex, for you. Would you let Dr. Stephen Greer operate on you?
You wouldn't know it. I mean, if I was in a car wreck and he was there and he didn't know it was me, because he would kill me, I think.
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah. Now you wouldn't let him operate on you. The odd thing is that the belief in aliens does not seem to slice along any particular demographic. It doesn't seem to be, you know, that smart people don't believe in them and dumb people do believe in them, or that it's a function of education or anything like that. Many, if not most, of the people in my book who are true believers in it are, you know, educated, very smart people who, in many cases, you know a lot about physics and a lot about the general subject of space travel and so forth. They just sort of take it a little bit further and they say, okay, well, the aliens, maybe they're using element 115 to get here in their spaceships. Well, what's element 115? Well, we don't know yet, but it's all predicted in theory. And so I was sort of struck by that the one thing that you could sort of say is that the belief in aliens seems to be very much an American thing. It's not exclusive to here. It's big in China now, actually, but it's certainly a popular belief here and in Mexico, and it's huge on the West Coast. Sorry, Michael, but it's Southern California. It is just, I mean, it is taken for granted that they're here.
Are these experiences with aliens and different realities, a new template to plug into cultures where the old religion has worn out. For example, the angels and devils of the medieval Europe have now become little grays and reptilians. I mean, for some reason, they seem to see characters out of the Bible, and we see characters out of the technological Bible.
And it's interesting also that it's since the rise of genetic engineering that the idea has arisen in the UFO world, the aliens are experimenting with our DNA to create hybrids, human-alien hybrids. In the same way that really the sighting of UFOs and the idea of alien spacecraft seems to be a 20th century phenomenon, of the idea that these are space vehicles postdates the rise of science fiction in this century. Most people want to be rational, and they will tell you they're skeptical. I mean, Jody is right. I mean, that I've talked to Bud Hopkins, and he will tell you he's a skeptic and that he just wants to know the truth, and he doesn't presume he has all the answers. But what I find is that someone will sit there and they'll spend half an hour giving me all their credentials about how skeptical they are, until I finally conceded, okay, you are the most skeptical person I've ever met. I mean, you're just total straight arrow, right down the middle. And then they tell me about the war between the humanoids and the reptilians. The thing about belief in aliens is you could say that this is a secular belief, okay, that that they're not angels, they're not demons, okay? These are not wispy creatures that are a product of a religious belief, that these are actual real creatures that have crossed interstellar space to come into our reality.
You mentioned a secular belief. I was amazed in the reading to come across a little piece of dialogue between Minister Louis Farrakhan and Ted Koppel, in which Ted Koppel checked the quote with Farrakhan about whether or not there was a mothership circling Earth that was going to, pardon me?
Ezekiel's wheel.
Yeah. Alex, did you want to
that's a big part of the Nation of Islam's belief, and it goes very far. There's going to be an apocalyptic war that will settle all the accounts. It's just, most people don't read that deeply in the religion to know about it.
That story actually comes from my book,
right.
From a radio show I was on in Los Angeles, a black radio station, and we were talking about UFOs and alien abduction, so it was me and the publisher of UFO Magazine, and the guy from Star Trek, The Next Generation, who plays Barclay, Dwight Schultz. He's a big UFO guy. And so we were doing the usual stuff about blurry photographs and grainy videos and things that go bump in the night and all that. Then we went to the phones, and callers started calling up saying, it's all true. I mean, the Reverend Farrakhan, he's been there. He's been to the mothership. And I thought, what is this? I had no idea. And so sure enough, when I looked into it, that's right. That's one of the tenets of at least Farrakhan's version of the religion. And so I actually wove that into a chapter in How We Believe called The God and the Ghost Dance. And because there was an apocalyptic theme to it that, and at the end of 1999 or 2000, the mothership will release all the smaller ships, just like Independence Day, and the big war, and the white government will be toppled. And, the blacks will be put back into the rightful position of power and so on. And it was very much like I immediately had this flash of insight. Oh, it's like the buffalo will return, the white man will leave, the Native Americans will rise again, and so on. It was just like the 1890 Native American ghost dance, the Dakota Sioux ghost dance. And so I blurted that out, and that went over, really well. the host says, "I believe in the ghost dance." It's like, okay, what does that mean to believe in the ghost dance or to believe in this? What does that mean? I mean, it's clearly there are mythic themes that repeat over and over and over, and this idea that the Savior will come is an ancient one. I mean, it's particularly amongst oppressed peoples. It's not just amongst oppressed peoples. I mean, people that like Hal Lindsey, probably drive BMWs. I don't know. But oppressed peoples certainly have reason to call forth a Savior, as did the Jews 2,000 years ago.
Speaking of oppressed people, how much do we need to write our own stories as we live them? How much do we need to create a narrative that connects all the little bits and pieces so that we don't live in some existential horror that's just a rock spinning meaninglessly? I could put that in English too, actually. Jody, I mean, how much do we
It's all yours, Jody.
How much do we narrate our own mythology in order to believe in something, whether it's Jesus and heaven or a wheel over the earth? And
I want to answer this in two ways. First of all, what the we is of our own mythology, right? Is that, are we saying this, like, does each individual person weave their own life narrative? In one way, yes, but of course it's in a general context. I think that right now, the sense of a general context is really dissolving. And it's dissolving just like we go to a million different websites and have a bunch of different television shows and a bunch of different media in front of us. So trying to put together a coherent narrative, trying to put together a big story, is increasingly difficult. I don't think, though, that that leads us to existential horror. It can lead us to a kind of wonderment. This, to me, is important because I worry that the story we've been told since the 1950s, that big science is going to save us, that, I think, is scary. That's what I think leads to a kind of existential horror. And that, in fact, if we have a whole bunch of different varieties, maybe we can find a different kind of enchantment with the world.
Speaking of the, well, of the existential horror and all the rest, Alex, did you find that the people who had were going toward alternative ways of living had actually gone so far away from all that stuff? Or were they also on the internet, and were they also part of the daily accelerating maelstrom?
I mean, again, I didn't infiltrate a doomsday cult where everybody was going to kill themselves. But there are groups like that out there. Most of these people use all the tools of daily life. They love the internet. I mean, it's the greatest thing that ever happened to in terms of getting the word out about what they're doing. They like technology. You know, what they don't like is what they see as orthodoxy, right or wrong. I mean, that's the way they see it.
Well, does this kind of stuff happen in smaller groups of people? Let's say, Michael, you touched upon the idea of 150 people being a community. Is it possible that within a smaller community, in a village, that the sense of connected lives and meaning in life doesn't call up the need to invent aliens?
Tough call. I'm not sure. The idea of that we evolved in small groups of 150 to 200 people is an interesting one, because it appears that the average person, if you look in your phone book, you count up how many people are in there that you really know pretty well, there'll be about 150 or so for any of us. And it could be, maybe, it's a little speculative, that we evolve, our brain is only big enough to retain the memories of close relationships for about 150, 200 people. Beyond that, it's hard to say much in detail about these people you run into. And that then may translate, which I do in the book, about how morality evolved, that is, how we came to develop reciprocal altruism. I'll scratch your back if you'll scratch mine. How do I know you're going to be a cooperator or a defector? And the way you know is you know the people. You know them well enough that you could say something of confidence about them. And the way we learn about other people is through language. It's called gossip. If you look at the sociology of gossip, believe it or not, people actually study this for a living. And I just steal their ideas, but it's fascinating. I mean, the top subjects of gossip are, who's sleeping with who and who's got the power and who the hierarchy, and it's relations, social relations, how people get along and who can we trust and who we can, who's a liar, who's a good guy, who's a bad guy. That's the nature of gossip, and the reason probably for that is this evolving in these little communities. That's how we came to be social animals without destroying ourselves. I think related to that, though, on this idea why do people believe weird things? Even more interesting, why do smart people believe weird things? That's where the action is. Wow, why is that? And why do, let's just take academics or professors or somebody, go off into a new field where they really bomb. And the reason is because of a mistaken idea that science is in the individual. It's a thing that's in your brain, and you can just take it with you somewhere else and investigate a whole new field. Now, occasionally that happens successfully, but usually not. And the reason is because science is actually a social process that has to do with a dialogue between a bunch of people, maybe 150, I don't know, but a number of experts in a community. And it probably is some small number like that where, if you talk to paleontologists, the guys, and they're divided between the invertebrate paleontologists and the vertebrate paleontologists, and they don't like each other. It's really hilarious. But they have these social relations, and they know each other. And And they have these dialogues that go on for a while and debates, and then the debate fades, and then they have a new debate. And the same thing is true in physics and so on. And so the guys that are on the outside that we all study, they don't know this. They don't know the social process. They don't read the journals. They don't go to the conferences. They don't read those books. They don't know what's going on. So they think that science is up here, and I'm smart, you know. Guys you talk to, yeah, I'm smart, I can do this. And they're kind of snobby and elite. What's to say that they know and I don't know? So they write these long single-space type manuscripts and they send them to me, or they send them to Caltech and they send them to me. And there are these theories about why Newton was wrong or Einstein was wrong. And the problem is the debate, the subject that they're writing about, that debate took place like 200 years ago or 100 years ago. Nobody's talking about that. They've resolved that problem. We're on to new things now. And it changes every 6 months or so. And they're so far behind. They don't know that it's a community process. And they have to be part of the community. And they feel left out. And that's what angers them.
Joel, did you find that with a lot of the scientists, the people who went into the research that you talk about, the aliens or the life on other planets, were they inspired by wild ideas as kids, sci-fi, fantasy, stuff like that?
Well, yes, as a matter of fact. First, I wanted to say that I learned something today, which is that the next time I can't remember someone's name, I can just say, I'm sorry, you're not one of my 150.
You're out of the, yeah,
I'm so sorry.
God.
You know, Sagan always talked about how when he was growing up, he read the books on Mars by Edgar Rice Burroughs, you know, where this guy John Carter just wishes himself to Mars, and suddenly he's up there, you know, battling and falling in love and all that sort of stuff. And so Sagan, you know, his whole life was obsessed with Mars, and certainly it had to some extent be because, you know, as a kid, I mean, he was so fascinated by the place. And I think a lot of people today who are working on the field of extraterrestrial life are people who came of age in the 60s when it looked like our trajectory was to become, you know, a galactic species, that we were going out there. I assume that you know, by the time I was 39, that maybe I would have gone to some other planet. I mean, it just seemed that was how it was going to play out. And then of course, after Apollo, suddenly, you know, the bottom dropped out, and they built the space shuttle, which goes about as far from the Earth as Washington is from Charlottesville. But the popular culture definitely has fueled a lot of the scientific interest in extraterrestrial life. And in my opinion, and based on just sort of my reading of the literature, there's been a tendency to be way too optimistic about the abundance of intelligence in the universe. And that may be in part because of Star Trek and of all the science fiction out there, and people, you know, they want to, you know, meet the Vulcans and the Klingons and the Romulans and all that, and so they tend to maybe take for granted the fact that it's such a long trek from the origin of life to the realization of an intelligent being. I mean, if you accept evolution as I do, and most scientifically minded people do, I believe, the story of life on Earth is a story of 3 billion years of life being stuck in a single-celled rut. I mean, it took forever to get to the point of being, you know, a jellyfish. So to be an intelligent creature, we could, you know, based on our own example, it would seem to take roughly 4 billion years. How many worlds are there out there that have had life on them capable of evolving for four billion years? Now, we don't know the answer to that. It could be a lot, or it could be a relatively rare phenomenon. But, you know, popular culture would tell us that it's easy. You know, you just, you know, they're all over the place.
Are we looking at two different intersecting waves of interest here, the slowness of scientific discovery and then the excitement of the X-Files and the paranoia, Jody? It certainly seems that the whole interest in everything else that can't be named ramped up very quickly with the X-Files.
I think the X-Files picked up on something that was already happening. Mm-hmm. In Aliens in America, I pinpoint what I think is a time when things start changing in the UFO culture and in popular culture in general is 1987, when there were the televangelism scandals. That's when the Iran-Contra stuff was going on. That's when there was a stock market crash. That's when two books on alien abduction make bestseller lists. And it's the year after this Challenger disaster. And I think the Challenger disaster really affected people very, very deeply. And I think it affected them in a way that they didn't think we could go out there anymore, and instead there becomes then a cultural space for us to have stories about the aliens coming here to us. I think that the changes in technology have made us more paranoid. So I'm not sure, if I would say that this rapidity of change, I think it's technological change rather than the slowness of science or evolution. I actually think that science has changed very fast and technology has changed very fast, and that's hard for us to deal with. The other thing, I have to say, these evolution arguments, the thing that bugs me is that they're saying over here on this side of the table that, oh, you know, it takes so long, it's really rare, all of this. And at the same time, I think that the UFO people, they say, oh, it takes forever, you know, this is a really slow change. And the UFO people are acting as if there wasn't some kind of long, slow process. I don't think that's true at all. I think that the UFO people can agree with everything that you guys are saying. I mean, you had to end up, Joel, by saying, we just don't know. They can agree with that, too. They can agree with the idea that there's a zillion planets and we don't know which are going to have life. So I don't think it's fair to make it seem like science is completely on your side, rather than science has so many holes, so many gaps, so many spaces that these people don't have a chance to come in and join a discussion.
Well, let me say that. My impression is that the people in the UFO world try very, very hard to prove their point, okay, by amassing evidence that validates their point, and are less willing than the typical sort of scientist to really grapple with evidence that may invalidate their point. I mean, one of the groups I went and talked to, well, actually, I didn't really talk to them. I went and sat in on a group of people who'd had experiences with aliens. It was an alien abduction group that was sort of morphing into a group called Starseed. These are the people who think that they themselves are from space. And the number one rule of the group was, you will not invalidate the experiences of others. Okay, if someone else says something, you will not invalidate that story. Now, my feeling is that's sort of the opposite of the way science works, where scientists are just trigger-happy invalidators. They love to run around and say, oh, that's not true, you know? I would agree with you that, you know, people like Bud Hopkins, he knows the story of evolution and it takes 4 billion years. And yeah, he's aware, like anyone else, you know, of the Drake equation and this sort of unknown of, you know, how abundant is life out there. I mean, I'm not saying that, you know, that the UFO people are oblivious to science. I mean, everyone has read the Carl Sagan books. Everyone, you know, people have the same database. I think there's a difference in the way they kind of approach the material, and that is why some people say there are no aliens here, and some people say, oh no, they are here, because it's the you know, we all have the same sort of database, but we have a different approach to analyzing the credibility of it.
There's something that you said that I think is really good and I really like, and that's the pointing out the difference in that the groups have a kind of rule of, you know, don't invalidate that. I think that one of the reasons that this is so prevalent now is because we're in a therapeutic culture. We're in a talk show culture. My original scholarship is in feminist work, and for a lot of feminist groups, there's an idea that you're supposed to respect other people's experiences, you're supposed to listen, you're supposed to approach discussion with a caring attitude. It could be the case that there's an unfortunate clash when this caring discussion style becomes now the basis for a scientific factual claim. And I agree with you on that. And I think that one of the weird issues in UFO research is what used to be the fuzzy photograph science becomes therapy culture. And that clash is how we get this abduction movement.
Therapy culture?
We have agreement.
And now we're taking questions.
Alex, did you find that a lot of therapy-minded culture among the people that you spoke to who wanted to live, for example, forever? I mean, there was one guy you spoke to who thought that something like in almost eternal life was available within his lifetime, didn't he?
Well, he hopes he'll cross a bridge and realize these immortality sciences that are supposedly coming. But the therapy thing, that operates in all these groups. And, you know, I would talk to people in Earth changes, again, that's the planet wants to kill us idea. And a lot of those people, you ask them, like, okay, where did you get this? And you find when you read it, it dates back to Edgar Cayce, and it comes out of the Bible. But they all say, I had a personal revelation that the Earth was crying out and telling me. And then you hit a little harder, and you find out there's usually some dysfunction there. And for some reason, this whole idea that the Earth is going to become violent, but then protect a certain number of us who are now getting in touch with the way we should be living on the Earth, they find that soothing. And it's very strange. That's true. All these beliefs usually have violence built in, and it's directed against other people. But there's always this idea that it's going to get terrible, and then we'll be in a utopia or a millennium, and I'll be one of the people that enjoys it. And it's a little bit selfish, but it's self-help, definitely.
Yes.
I'm fascinated by this discussion. Is this on?
I'm not sure, but we can hear you.
You can hear me anyway. All right. There seems to be an unasked assumption behind each of your comments, and I'd like to hear from each panelist their views on this. Is there any absolute truth beyond an individual's belief system? And if so, why do you believe that?
Wow, the big question. Wow.
We were hoping no one would ask
the
that.
The entire philosophy. I can't believe something. We were just talking about, I hope no one asked that one. Yeah.
It's the meteor strike we were afraid of. Yeah.
I think, yes, I think there's an absolute, just talk about extraterrestrial life, I think there's a certain biology to the universe that someday we'll discover, and that it's independent of what we think it ought to be. I mean, it is sort of like waiting for us to find out what the truth is. But in general, I do think that some things are, in fact, true, and that I'm not a relativist. You know, I don't think everyone's vote counts on this. I think some things are just true.
Yeah, I agree. To ask the question, you must know there's a huge body of literature on this subject, from the strong program of the British who say it's largely relativistic and there are no truths, to equally fanatics on the other side. Obviously, as I've said, science is a social process. So there is what I think and how I perceive, and then my community of people that I hang out with and who I talk to, and what we sort of concur with each other. And then there's sort of a methodology we agree is a pretty good methodology, where we run experiments and we can get more confident in particular claims. And certain areas, like the physical sciences, I think have more confidence than some others, like the social sciences, where things get a lot fuzzier, and all that I already said. And I think, but that's in part answering the question that, there are truths, but I think fuzzy logic is the way to look at it. We can assign gradations, like the sky is 0.9 blue or 0.6 blue. We can say that, certain tenets about evolutionary theory were 0.99 confident, but we're less confident about other aspects of it. And other sciences, we'd assign it a 0.2 or something like that.
I don't think that there is any truth that we can access. I don't think that there's any ultimate or absolute truth that humans can touch, understand, reach. I think it's out there, and it sometimes might intrude on us in ways that we might not understand, but I don't think that we can get there. I guess I'd say I'm a relativist, to the extent that what I believe is relative to my community, to my experience, to where I'm situated here in time, and that to say otherwise strikes me as bizarre, right? How could you be anything but, how could you have a sense of truth, anything that, in a way that wasn't relative to who and where and what you are at a given moment? So I'll go out there and be a relativist. But again, it's just because we can't ever get there. We're already too situated in the world.
I would agree with what Joel said, and I think I'm just a little more interested in why people are so, how they're driven to try to test the boundaries. And I like to try, that was what I did a lot in this book. I tried some of these things. I went to out-of-body experience camp and tried to have one. And I was hoping, I did not rule it out, but I don't really believe that it happens, but I did try to sincerely go for it. And so the thing that is interesting is that most of the people making these fantastic claims, that's part of their argument, is there's no absolute truth, but they're asking you to accept something that's unproven. And it really should work the other way. It's like, okay, we know that Newton's laws hold up under most circumstances. Now, you prove to me that your free energy perpetual motion machine works. And they usually, that's when they usually fall back on these weird arguments that evade. They say, I can't because the government will kill me. And it, really, they do. I have to stay underground for now. And so, you know, that it's true then that you don't have to listen to that anymore. So, but
you can always tell them the only known perpetual motion machine is the exact size of the universe.
So far, it's perpetual.
So far.
Thank you. I want to ask Jody, do you believe aliens have come to Earth or not? Yes or no? I know. I asked you that on my radio show, and you said you wouldn't answer. But I'm come on. Now listen.
Well, but
no one's an agnostic.
But she already did answer a second ago. She said, as a relativist, she would say that that's a piece of, I'm defending her. That's a piece of that's a judgment that she doesn't think necessarily we can make.
Okay.
You can do better than that, actually. I mean, but.
I probably can't. I mean, I absolutely can't answer the question. Okay, all I can say is that I know. I mean, all I can say is what we can all say, namely that we know that there are people who believe that. Right? I mean, I believe that belief is always something that we do through other people. Right? Belief is, as you say, right? Belief is a community, a community, an element of being in a community with other people. I happen to not be in a community where this is something that we have happened to us. So I'm interested in those communities. But it's not something that happens to me or my friends.
I think another way to approach it, and maybe you don't have to answer this one directly, but I have a whole section in my Weird Things book on the Holocaust deniers. I have a whole book coming out about these guys. And there's a trial going on in England where this guy David Irving is suing Deborah Lipstadt for calling him a Holocaust denier. Now, is it equally plausible that the Holocaust happened or it didn't happen? Are those truths equal? Is it okay? Are you open to the idea that, yeah, maybe it didn't happen and that these guys, they have a right to that truth, and that truth may be true, and we really can't tell if it happened or not.
I'm glad you asked that, because that's always the attack that someone who's a relativist gets. And I would say, of course not, right? I know that the Holocaust happened, but I think I know this for all sorts of reasons that have to do with the communities I'm in, the politics I've had, the history I read, and I'm not going to convince a Holocaust denier just by saying, I know the truth, you don't. I have to get in there and fight with them and argue against them and prove them and show that they're, you know, bad guy Nazis, right, for denying this. But it's a political argument. It's a political struggle against those people, and just to say, I have truth and you don't, is not going to carry the day. You have to fight it out.
I agree. So how is that different from what I do with the alien abductees? Although they're harmless compared to the Holocaust deniers, and they're nice people compared to the Holocaust deniers, but the process is the same. You get in there and you say, no, here's why I think you're not. It's not that you're bad, it's that you're wrong.
Excuse me. Yes. I'm so entertained.
Well, but I don't know.
Yes, question from the audience.
One direction this discussion has been headed is what is the practical harm of people believing unusual things? And one thing I'd like to point out, Alex, you spoke a little bit about Stephen Greer, and I actually went to one of his programs, and it struck me when I was there, and you echoed it just a moment ago when you talked about, well, I've got the perpetual motion machine, but the government will kill me if I show it to you. And the pitch he actually does at his programs, which you have to pay to get in, and he charges a pretty hefty sum for his the UFOs seminars, is, oh, we're looking for investors so we can make a working model of this, and we'll have something that will fit on a tabletop and provide the entire energy needs of India. And it's almost like a con man show, in a sense, or the perpetual motion con. So I guess my question is to each of you, what is practically the harm for society of people believing this, and what can be done about it?
Well,
here's a good example. What I always say is it's okay for you to wave your fists in the air as long as it doesn't hit my nose. And Greer, I think his fist does sort of hit society's nose. I don't think he's a criminal, but I think he's in a gray area where he's manipulating a lot of people. Why? And he charges a lot, and he has these schemes. I think he believes all this stuff. What he gets out of it is he likes to be the big man who travels around the world lecturing, and he wants other people to pay for it. There are much more extreme examples where people want to be the head of a cult where everybody gives them everything, and that's the dynamic. But, you know, so it goes all over. But usually, there are clear boundaries. I mean, when someone commits a crime, they can say they have a perpetual motion machine, fine, and they can argue about it, and they can say the government's trying to kill them. But as soon as they start selling shares to ignorant farmers, which a character in my book did, that he was selling them $50,000 shares for franchise rights for this perpetual motion machine, that's when it's clearly over the line. Violence, manipulation to the point of someone losing their life. And so that's, to me, just as soon as it gets to that point, then there is a harm. There's also laws in place to do something about it, usually.
Oh, the same question? I like Alex's answer. I'm just going to say, yeah, that's right.
Press your vote button.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
Michael, is there any harm to any of this, or is it?
Yeah, they get shades of gray. I think the astrologers are relatively harmless compared to, say, the Holocaust deniers, this sort of thing. It depends on the claim and the context. We've done a couple issues of Skeptic. We did one on race and IQ, and the one we have coming out in a couple weeks is on race and sports. There's a book out about, it's called Taboo, Why Blacks Dominate Sports and Why We're Afraid to Talk About It. Apparently we're not, because this book has been plastered all over the media. So, but I'm curious. Okay, so you have the data, and you discuss the data about what these different, are the differences real, what do they mean, that sort of thing. But I'm always curious, why is it it's usually the same people who are interested in these black and white differences, and why this is an American discussion? Why has nobody written a book, Why Asians Dominate Ping Pong, and Why We're Afraid to Talk About It? They don't. We don't care. Nobody cares. And it probably means nothing. But why is it that black-white differences make so much, are so important to some people in America at this time? Those kinds of discussions can be dangerous to people, because we live in a culture in which that has ramifications. That it's not just a question of, well, I'm interested in this instead of that, like I like chocolate instead of tapioca pudding or something. It's not a neutral choice. People are interested in certain subjects for a reason, and that's when it can get, when it turns into fanaticism, that's when it becomes dangerous.
Joel, have you seen fanaticism hinder the work of scientists at all, from people who take their beliefs too far?
I want to answer the question this gentleman asked. I think that in the least extreme cases, the belief in aliens often becomes obsessive with some people. Their whole world becomes wrapped up with the belief that there is a hybridization program going on at this moment, and that we are essentially, I mean, it's like in Alex's book, you know, there's an apocalyptic quality to this, which when it takes root in a family, it can be really disruptive to, or it can destroy families, it can destroy a person's job, it can have a definite impact on a person's life if they become obsessed with one of these kind of fringe assertions. But a really extreme example, I went to this UFO convention. There's a guy up there talking about how Comet Hale Bob had this companion object. He showed, you know, pictures of this flying saucer thing, and supposedly the next morning there was going to be a gravity wave pass through the Earth. It was going to activate 12 strands of DNA and raise us all to a higher vibrational level. And I'm like, I didn't know what they were talking about. I thought it was vaguely amusing. The Heaven's Gate people were at that conference. They bought the guy's book, okay? They bought his tapes, okay? They read all this stuff. They had shelves of material about aliens and abductions, you know, and they were part of the culture. And they found validation constantly for their, what seems to us to be kind of a wacky belief system, and they killed themselves. So that's the extreme example. That's rare, I grant you. But it's a window on, I think, a kind of broader problem of people becoming obsessed with ideas which are not true, but which sort of, you know, it's almost like a thought contagion. You know, once you buy into it, it's really hard to extricate yourself.
People can become obsessed and fanatical about anything. And it worries me when obsessed and fanatical are attached to some kinds of so-called fringe beliefs as opposed to other kinds of beliefs. So you can have people who become obsessed and fanatical about, you know, gun control or about having guns, about the environment, or about, you know, whatever the anti-environmentalists will be. So I think it's important to not make the critique of fanaticism the same thing as a critique of UFO belief.
Alex, when, as the executive editor at Wired, did you deal a lot with fanaticism in Y2K? Did that seem...
Well, I mean, Wired, before I got there, published an article that had software programmers heading for the hills, and that caused a lot of people to go, wait a second, if Wired's saying that, and I think it was edited a little murkily, that they never... Wired at that time never said, by the way, we do not believe you need to worry about Y2K. They kind of left that muddy, and that, I thought that was actually a disservice because that scared a lot of people. And they said, see, these experts are worried too. And they weren't trying to do that. They were just trying to say there are these software guys and they believe it and they're gone. So,
well, speaking of going, I'm afraid we've run out of time. I'd like to thank everybody again, Joel Achenbach, Michael Shermer, Jody Dean, and Alex Hurd. They'll be signing immediately following, and thank you for coming out.
For information about the Virginia Festival of the Book, visit their website at www.vabook.org. Or call 804-924-3296.
Detail about these people you run into, and that then may translate, which I do in the book, about how morality evolved. That is how we came to develop reciprocal altruism. I'll scratch your back if you'll scratch mine. How do I know you're going to be a cooperator or a defector? And the way you know is you know the people. You know them well enough that you could say something of confidence about them. And the way we learn about other people is through language. It's called gossip. If you look at the sociology of gossip, believe it or not, people actually study this for a living. And I just steal their ideas. But it's fascinating. I mean, the top subjects of gossip are, you know, who's sleeping with who and who's got the power and who the hierarchy. And it's relations, social relations, how people get along and who can we trust and who can, who's a liar, who's a good guy, who's a bad guy. That's the nature of gossip. And the reason probably for that is this evolving in these little communities. That's how we came to be social animals without destroying ourselves. I think related to that, though, on this idea of why do people believe weird things, even more interesting, why do smart people believe weird things? That's where the action is. Wow, why is that? And why do, let's just take academics or professors or somebody, go off into a new field where they really bomb. And the reason is because of a mistaken idea that science is in the individual. It's a thing that's in your brain, and you can just take it with you somewhere else and investigate a whole new field. Now, occasionally that happens successfully, but usually not. And the reason is because science is actually a social process that has to do with a dialogue between a bunch of people. Maybe 150, I don't know. But a number of experts in a community, and it probably is some small number like that, where, you know, if you talk to paleontologists, the guys, and they're divided between the invertebrate paleontologists and the vertebrate paleontologists, they don't like each other. It's really hilarious. But they have these social relations, and they know each other, and they have these dialogues that go on for a while and debates, and then the debate fades, and then they have a new debate. And the same thing is true in physics and so on. And so the guys that are on the outside, that we all study, they don't know this. They don't know the social process. They don't read the journals. They don't go to the conferences. They don't read those books. They don't know what's going on. So they think that science is up here, and I'm smart, you know. Guys you talk to, yeah, I'm smart. I can do this. And they're kind of snobby and elite. What's to say that they know and I don't know? So they write these long single-space type manuscripts, and they send them to me, or they send them to Caltech, and they send them to me. And there are these theories about why Newton was wrong or Einstein was wrong, and the problem is the debate, the subject that they're writing about that debate took place like 200 years ago or 100 years ago. Nobody's talking about that. They've resolved that problem. We're on to new things now, and it changes every 6 months or so. And they're so far behind. They don't know that it's a community process, and they have to be part of the community, and they feel left out, and that's what angers them.
Joel, did you find that with a lot of the scientists, the people who went into the research that you talk about, the aliens or the life on other planets, were they inspired by wild ideas as kids, sci-fi, fantasy, stuff like that?
Well, yes, as a matter of fact. First, I want to say that I learned something today, which is that the next time I can't remember someone's name, I can just say, I'm sorry, you're not one of my 150.
You're out of the, yeah,
I'm so sorry.
Somebody
has to go out and put somebody new in. You know, Sagan always talked about how when he was growing up, he read the books on Mars by Edgar Rice Burroughs, you know, where this guy, John Carter, just wishes himself to Mars, and suddenly he's up there, you know, battling and falling in love and all that sort of stuff. And so Sagan, you know, his whole life was obsessed with Mars, and certainly it had to some extent, be because, you know, as a kid, I mean, he was so fascinated by the place. I think a lot of people today who are working on the field of extraterrestrial life are people who came of age in the 60s when it looked like our trajectory was to become, you know, a galactic species, that we were going out there. I assume that you know, by the time I was 39, that maybe I would have gone to some other planet. I mean, it just seemed that was how it was going to play out. And then, of course, after Apollo, suddenly, you know, the bottom dropped out, and they built the space shuttle, which goes about as far from the Earth as Washington is from Charlottesville. But the popular culture definitely has fueled a lot of the scientific interest in extraterrestrial life. And in my opinion, and based on just sort of my reading of the literature, there's been a tendency to be way too optimistic about the abundance of intelligence in the universe. And that may be in part because, of Star Trek and of all the science fiction out there. And people, you know, they want to, you know, meet the Vulcans and the Klingons and the Romulans and all that. And so they tend to maybe take for granted the fact that it's such a long trek from the origin of life to the realization of an intelligent being. I mean, if you accept evolution as I do, and most scientifically minded people do, I believe, the story of life on Earth is a story of 3 billion years of life being stuck in a single-celled rut. I mean, it took forever to get to the point of being, you know, a jellyfish. So to be an intelligent creature, we could, you know, based on our own example, it would seem to take roughly 4 billion years. How many worlds are there out there that have had life on them capable of evolving for four billion years? Now, we don't know the answer to that. It could be a lot, or it could be a relatively rare phenomenon. But, you know, popular culture would tell us that it's easy. You know, you just, you know, they're all over the place.
Are we looking at two different intersecting waves of interest here, the slowness of scientific discovery and then the excitement of the X-Files and the paranoia, Jody? It certainly seems that the whole interest in everything else that can't be named ramped up very quickly with the X-Files.
I think the X-Files picked up on something that was already happening. Mm-hmm. In Aliens in America, I pinpoint what I think is a time when things start changing in the UFO culture and in popular culture in general is 1987, when there were the televangelism scandals. That's when the Iran-Contra stuff was going on. That's when there was a stock market crash. That's when two books on alien abduction make bestseller lists. And it's the year after this Challenger disaster. And I think the Challenger disaster really affected people very, very deeply. And I think it affected them in a way that they didn't think we could go out there anymore, and instead there becomes a cultural space for us to have stories about the aliens coming here to us. I think that the changes in technology have made us more paranoid. So I'm not sure, if I would say that this rapidity of change, I think it's technological change rather than the slowness of science or evolution. I actually think that science has changed very fast and technology has changed very fast, and that's hard for us to deal with. The other thing, I have to say, these evolution arguments, the thing that bugs me is that they're saying over here on this side of the table that, oh, you know, it takes so long, it's really rare, all of this. And at the same time, I think that the UFO people, and they, well, so what they do, they say, oh, it takes forever, you know, this is a really slow change. And the UFO people are acting as if there wasn't some kind of long, slow process. I don't think that's true at all. I think that the UFO people can agree with everything that you guys are saying. I mean, you had to end up, Joel, by saying, we just don't know. They can agree with that, too. They can agree with the idea that there's a zillion planets and we don't know which are going to have life. So I don't think it's fair to make it seem like science is completely on your side, rather than science has so many holes, so many gaps, so many spaces that these people don't have a chance to come in and join a discussion.
Well, let me say that. My impression is that the people in the UFO world try very, very hard to prove their point, okay, by amassing evidence that validates their point, and are less willing than the typical sort of scientist to really grapple with evidence that may invalidate their point. I mean, one of the groups I went and talked to, well, actually, I didn't really talk to them. I went and sat in on a group of people who'd had experiences with aliens. It was an alien abduction group that was sort of morphing into a group called Starseed. These are the people who think that they themselves are from space. And the number one rule of the group was, you will not invalidate the experiences of others. Okay, if someone else says something, you will not invalidate that story. Now, my feeling is that's sort of the opposite of the way science works, where scientists are just trigger happy invalidators. They love to run around and say, oh, that's not true, you know. I would agree with you that, you know, people like Bud Hopkins, he knows the story of evolution and it takes 4 billion years, and yeah, he's aware, like anyone else, you know, of the Drake equation and this sort of unknown of, you know, how abundant is life out there. I mean, I'm not saying that, you know, that the UFO people are oblivious to science. I mean, everyone has read the Carl Sagan books. Everyone, you know, people have the same database. I think there's a difference in the way they kind of approach the material, and that is why some people say there are no aliens here, and some people say, oh no, they are here, because it's the you know, we all have the same sort of database. We have a different approach to analyzing the credibility of it.
There's something that you said that I think is really good and I really like, and that's the pointing out the difference in that the groups have a kind of rule of, you know, don't invalidate that. I think that one of the reasons that this is so prevalent now is because we're in a therapeutic culture. We're in a talk show culture. My original scholarship is in feminist work, and for a lot of feminist groups, there's an idea that you're supposed to respect other people's experiences, you're supposed to listen, you're supposed to approach discussion with a caring attitude. It could be the case that there's an unfortunate clash when this caring discussion style becomes now the basis for a scientific factual claim. And I agree with you on that, and I think that one of the weird issues in UFO research is what used to be the fuzzy photograph science becomes therapy culture, and that clash is how we get this abduction movement.
Therapy culture?
We have agreement.
And now we're taking questions.
Alex, did you find that a lot of therapy-minded culture among the people that you spoke to who wanted to live, for example, forever? I mean, there was one guy you spoke to who thought that something like in almost eternal life was available within his lifetime, didn't he?
Well, he hopes he'll cross a bridge and realize these immortality sciences that are supposedly coming. But the therapy thing, that operates in all these groups. And, you know, I would talk to people in Earth changes, again, that's the planet wants to kill us idea. And a lot of those people, you ask them, like, okay, where did you get this? And you find when you read it, it dates back to Edgar Cayce, and it comes out of the Bible. But they all say, I had a personal revelation that the Earth was crying out and telling me. And then you hit a little harder, and you find out there's usually some dysfunction there. And for some reason, this whole idea that the Earth is going to become violent but then protect a certain number of us who are now getting in touch with the way we should be living on the Earth, they find that soothing. And it's very strange. That's true, all these beliefs usually have violence built in, and it's directed against other people. But there's always this idea that it's going to get terrible, and then we'll be in a utopia or a millennium, and I'll be one of the people that enjoys it. And it's a little bit selfish, but it's self-help, definitely.
Hmm. Yes.
I'm fascinated by this discussion. Is this on?
We can hear you anyway.
All right. There seems to be an unasked assumption behind each of your comments, and I'd like to hear from each panelist their views on this. Is there any absolute truth beyond an individual's belief system? And if so, why do you believe that?
Wow, the big question. Wow.
We were hoping no one would ask
the entire bus. I can't believe something. We were just talking about, I hope no one asked that one. Yeah.
That's the meteor strike we were afraid of. Yeah.
I think there is an absolute, just talk about extraterrestrial life. I think there's a certain biology to the universe that someday we'll discover, and that it's independent of what we think it ought to be. I mean, it is sort of like waiting for us to find out what the truth is. But in general, I do think that some things are, in fact, true. And that I'm not a relativist. You know, I don't think everyone's vote counts on this. I think some things are just true.
Yeah, I agree. To ask the question, you must know there's a huge body of literature on this subject, from the strong program of the British who say, it's largely relativistic and there are no truths to.
A support group for abductees, as does Mac. Mac also has a support group where abductees can come in and talk about their experiences.
Now, didn't John Mac run into some trouble at Harvard because of allegations that he had brainwashed some of his patients?
Well, I think that's a little extreme. He almost lost his tenure, and he had to fight a very expensive legal battle to keep his tenure because the rest of the faculty in psychiatry thought that he had gone too far, but he won. There was a set of allegations of someone that it was all published in Time.
Somebody who pretended to
be one
of
his patients? Yeah, a woman pretended to be an abductee and said wild things like, and then I was abducted and Khrushchev and Kennedy were there, and Mac apparently is going, yeah, really, what else? And she was making it all up, and he was all believing it. And later she came out and said she made it up. And weirdly, he came out and said, oh, I think it was true, she's just in denial now, which was not a great answer, especially for people like me who are trying to make them not look so crazy. That's Mac.
Have you found a discernible lack of skepticism on their part? I mean, for example, we could say from the scientific point of view that they're always trying to disprove each other, and that's what keeps them on their toes. Mm-hmm. But is it generally the case, or possibly the case, that in the alien community or the paranoid community, that anything goes and skepticism is frowned upon?
I don't think so. I had breakfast at Bud Hopkins last year, and what was so wild to me is Hopkins and some of his friends were all there trashing the satanic child abuse people. I mean, they're like, oh, I can't believe anybody would ever believe this. Oh, they're crazy false memory people. What, they're lunatics? Have you read their stuff? It's totally unscientific. So they were really skeptical about the satanic child abuse cult aspects of a belief system.
And that came from a professor at the University of Chicago, didn't it?
I think a lot of
same sort of standard of high education, I guess. Alex, is a lot of this just a way of living for people, that they just retreat from the world, or are they looking for some kind of nirvana also?
Well, it completely varies. It can be everything. Some of these things are like going to church on Sunday. That's the level of involvement. Some of them are like cults where people change their lives and disappear. The gray area in between is the most common, and you find that most people work these beliefs into pretty ordinary lives. Or it sounds like a cult, but it's really just a church. One of my groups is the Unarius Academy of Science, which is a UFO group in San Diego, near San Diego. They believe Space Brothers are landing next year, and they will herald in a new age. It's a small group, and the people volunteer, and they pay a little money, every week. It's not, but it's like tithing. It's not like a cult offering. And these are people who, most of them seem to have some kind of problem in their background. A lot of times it was drugs, but this is their little church, and that's what I found to to be usually the case. It's more of a hobby than like all-consuming thing that takes you out of the mainstream. Another guy, probably some people have heard of around here, Dr. Stephen Greer, who's an MD, who has an organization called CSETI, and it's the Center for the Study of Extraterrestrial Intelligence, and he trains people to go out at night and literally try to flag UFOs to land on them. And he's utterly serious, and it's all tied into this grandiose view of the way the future is going to change once this happens and once he makes this contact. But the guy goes to work at an emergency room every day, or he used to. Mm-hmm. So that's one of the fascinating things. He has this, I think, insane belief and practice, but then he's got this other channel where he's utterly rational and able to perform. Mm-hmm. And I saw that again and again.
Yeah, let me ask. So far we're talking about doctors and scientists and people who are ostensibly very well educated and seem very competent in their regular lives. To what extent is this a function of class or income? Is this just a form of intellectual tennis club membership? I mean, does it spread around the world? For example, why haven't aliens landed in New Delhi?
It does seem that there are entire countries where the aliens do not visit for some reason. I have a question, for Alex, for you. Would you let Dr. Stephen Greer operate on you?
You wouldn't know it. I mean, if I was in a car wreck and he was there and he didn't know it was me, because he would kill me, I think.
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah. Now you wouldn't let him operate on you. Now, I mean, the odd thing is that the belief in aliens does not seem to slice along any particular demographic. It doesn't seem to be, you know, that smart people don't believe in them and dumb people do believe in them, or that it's a function of education or anything like that. Many, if not most, of the people in my book who are true believers in it are, you know, educated, very smart people who, in many cases, you know a lot about physics and a lot about, the general subject of space travel and so forth. They just sort of take it a little bit further, and they say, okay, well, the aliens, maybe they're using element 115 to get here in their spaceships. Well, what's element 115? Well, we don't know yet, but, but it's all predicted in theory. And so I was sort of struck by that the one thing that you could sort of say is that the belief in aliens seems to be very much an American thing. It's not exclusive to here. It's big in China now, actually. But it's certainly a popular belief here and in Mexico, and it's huge on the West Coast. Sorry, Michael, but it's Southern California. It is just, I mean, it is taken for granted that they're here.
Are these experiences with aliens and different realities a new template to plug into cultures where the old religion has worn out? For example, the angels and devils of the medieval Europe have now become little grays and reptilians. I mean, for some reason, they seem to see characters out of the Bible, and we see characters out of the technological Bible.
And it's interesting also that it's since the rise of genetic engineering that the idea has arisen in the UFO world, the aliens are experimenting with our DNA to create hybrids, human-alien hybrids. In the same way that really the sighting of UFOs and the idea of alien spacecraft seems to be a 20th century phenomenon, of the idea that these are space vehicles really postdates the rise of science fiction in this century. Most people want to be rational, and they will tell you they're skeptical. I mean, Jody is right. I mean, that I've talked to Bud Hopkins, and he will tell you he's a skeptic, and that he just wants to know the truth, and he doesn't presume he has all the answers. But what I find is that someone will sit there and they'll spend half an hour giving me all their credentials about how skeptical they are, until I finally concede, okay, you are the most skeptical person I've ever met. I mean, you're just total straight arrow, right down the middle. And then they tell me about the war between the humanoids and the reptilians, and the thing about belief in aliens is you could say that this is a secular belief, okay? That these, that they're not angels, they're not demons, okay? These are not wispy creatures that are
a product of a religious belief, that these are actual real creatures that have crossed interstellar space to come into our reality.
You mentioned a secular belief. I was amazed in the reading to come across a little piece of dialogue between Minister Louis Farrakhan and Ted Koppel, in which Ted Koppel checked the quote with Farrakhan about whether or not there was a mothership circling Earth that was going to, pardon me?
Ezekiel's wheel.
Yeah. Alex, did you want to
just? I mean, that's a big part of the Nation of Islam's belief, and it goes very far. There's going to be an apocalyptic war that will settle all the accounts. It's just most people don't read that deeply in the religion to know about it.
But that story actually comes from my book,
right.
From a radio show I was on in Los Angeles, a black radio station, and we were talking about UFOs and alien abductions. So it was me and the publisher of UFO magazine, and the guy from Star Trek: The Next Generation, who plays Barclay, Dwight Schultz. He's a big UFO guy. And so we were doing the usual stuff about blurry photographs and grainy videos and things that go bump in the night and all that. Then we went to the phones, and callers started calling up saying, it's all true. I mean, the Reverend Farrakhan, he's been there. He's been to the mothership. And I thought, what is this? I had no idea. And so sure enough, when I looked into it, that's right. That's one of the tenets of Lise Farrakhan's version of the religion. And so I actually wove that into a chapter in How We Believe called The God and the Ghost Dance. And because there was an apocalyptic theme to it, that, you know, and at the end of 1999 or 2000, the mothership will release all the smaller ships, just like Independence Day, and the big war, and the white government will be toppled, and you know the blacks will be put back into the rightful position of power and so on. And it was very much like I immediately had this flash of insight. Oh, you know, it's like the buffalo will return, the white man will leave, the Native Americans will rise again, and so on. It was just like the 1890 Native American ghost dance, the Dakota Sioux ghost dance. And so I blurted that out, and that went over, you know, really well. the host says, I believe in the ghost dance. It's like, okay. What does that mean, to believe in the ghost dance or to believe in this? What does that mean? I mean, it's clearly there are mythic themes that repeat over and over and over, and this idea that the Savior will come is an ancient one. I mean, it's particularly amongst oppressed peoples. It's not just amongst oppressed peoples. I mean, people that like Hal Lindsey, you know, probably drive BMWs. I don't know. But oppressed peoples certainly have reason to call forth a Savior, as did the Jews 2,000 years ago.
How, speaking of oppressed people, how much do we need to write our own stories as we live them? How much do we need to create a narrative that connects all the little bits and pieces so that we don't live in some existential horror that's just a rock spinning meaninglessly? I could put that in English too, actually. Jody, I mean, how much do we
it's all yours, Jody.
How much do we narrate our own mythology in order to believe in something, whether it's Jesus and heaven or a wheel over the earth? And
I want to answer this in two ways. First of all, what the we is of our own mythology, right? Is that, are we saying this, like, does each individual person weave their own life narrative? In one way, yes, but of course it's in a general context. I think that right now, the sense of a general context is really dissolving. And it's dissolving just like we go to a million different websites and have a bunch of different television shows and a bunch of different media in front of us. So trying to put together a coherent narrative, trying to put together a big story, is increasingly difficult. I don't think, though, that leads us to existential horror. It can lead us to a kind of wonderment. This, to me, is important because I worry that the story we've been told since the 1950s, that big science is going to save us, that, I think, is scary. That's what I think leads to a kind of existential horror. And that, in fact, if we have a whole bunch of different varieties, maybe we can find a different kind of enchantment with the world.
Speaking of the, of the existential horror and all the rest, Alex, did you find that the people who were going toward alternative ways of living had actually gone so far away from all that stuff? Or were they also on the internet? Were they also part of the daily accelerating maelstrom?
I mean, again, I didn't infiltrate a doomsday cult where everybody was going to kill themselves. but there, I mean, there are groups like that out there. Most of these people use all the tools of daily life. They love the internet. I mean, it's the greatest thing that ever happened to, in terms of getting the word out about what they're doing. They like technology, you know. What they don't like is what they see as orthodoxy, right or wrong. I mean, that's the way they see it.
Well, does this kind of stuff happen in smaller groups of people? Let's say, Michael, you touched upon the idea of 150 people being a community. Is it possible that within a smaller community, in a village, that the sense of connected lives and meaning in life doesn't call up the need to invent aliens?
Tough call. I'm not sure. The idea of that we evolved in small groups of 150 to 200 people is an interesting one, because it appears that the average person, if you look in your phone book, you count up how many people are in there that you really know pretty well, there'll be about 150 or so for any of us. And it could be, maybe, it's a little speculative, that we evolve, our brain is only big enough to retain the memories of close relationships for about 150, 200 people. Beyond that, it's hard to say much.
From the Virginia Festival of the Book in Charlottesville, Virginia, a discussion with several authors who have written about unexplained phenomena, including conspiracy theories and supernatural experiences. The conversation lasts about an hour and a half.
Well, looks like this is it. Can you all hear me? Everybody hear me? Let me just begin by getting a feel for where everyone is in the audience. Is there anybody here who can claim to have seen a UFO? Hands? A couple? Is there anyone here who can claim to have seen ghosts or anything like that? Out-of-body experiences? A couple? Is there anybody here who belongs to a cult? Yeah, Episcopal Church counts, actually. Is there anybody here who is packing right now? Well, I guess we can proceed then. Yeah. Today's subject ostensibly is American lunacies, and without being too flip about the what's going on in the culture, what I'd like to do with the panel is examine, take the temperature basically of the zeitgeist, find out what's going on at the end of the millennium. Today's panelists include Joel Achenbach, who's a Washington Post columnist for the Washington Post daily online paper. His books include Why Things Are and Captured by Aliens. Next, we have Michael Shermer, who's the editor of Skeptic Magazine. He's the author of Why People Believe Weird Things and How We Believe. And on my right, we have Jody Dean, who's an associate professor at Hobart and Williams College. Have I got that right? I'm sorry, Hobart and William Smith College. And her book is Aliens in America. On the far right is Alex Hurd, the executive editor of Wired Magazine, whose book is Apocalypse Pretty Soon.
Not too late.
It's never too late for an apocalypse, I guess. What I'd like to do is just ask everybody generally, in the broadest possible brushstrokes, to paint in where they think we are now compared to, let's say, the 1960s. Is this a kind of quiet upheaval going on with all the cults, or is this something totally new? Alex, what's your take on that?
Okay, well, I don't have any data on this. It's all just based on my reporting and reading I did. I think that there obviously was a lot of millennial and apocalyptic activity around the turn of the millennium, but one of the things is there always has been. I think the media noticed it more, and they will also tend to think that it's all going away, because most of the media attention was on Y2K, and that fizzled, and most of those people have gone away, but a lot of them, you'll find over the years, if you keep up with this, will shift their energies about that to something else. And one of the new things, there's a bestseller by Art Bell called The Coming Age of Global Superstorms. And that's gonna capture a lot of those people, because he's saying that global warming and environmental change is going to bring a new kind of chaos and just storms that kill millions of people. So I think we're in a pretty active period and always will be.
I understand Virginia, particularly, this is something we can all be proud of here. Virginia
has quite a few cults going. Is that?
Yeah, although I first thing I'd do is I don't really talk about cults much, mm-hmm. except in the rare cases where that term applies. Most of these groups are political or religious groups. They just happen to be on the fringe. And cult is a pretty loaded term that doesn't really go for most of these people. But yeah, Virginia has everything. UFO people. There's a famous place called the Monroe Institute, a few miles from here, where they teach you to have out-of-body experiences, which at first glance doesn't seem millennial, but if you read the doctrines behind it, it is a very revelatory thing that has a long view attached to it.
Mm-hmm. Joel, what's your take on where the zeitgeist is right now?
Well, there's been a big change since the 1960s, really. I'm glad you brought that up, because it used to be that UFOs were very much of a hardware issue. People saw stuff in the skies they didn't understand. They saw, you know, lights or at least objects moving around in a strange way. And since then, it's become a much more personal thing, more of a software type issue in which people have these direct experiences. For that reason, I try not to convert people to my own personal belief about aliens, which basically is that if I were to wake up one morning and find, you know, three little bald-headed skinny creatures with three fingers each chewing on my foot, I still wouldn't believe in aliens. But I try not to convert people, because I know how personal the belief is to them. And for example, in my book kind of goes all over the place. I spend time talking to Carl Sagan and time talking to the people at NASA. But I also spent some time in UFO country, and a couple of the characters are people who believe that they themselves are aliens, that they think they're from the Pleiades, or that their spirit is from space. And this makes perfect sense to them, and it kind of explains why in their life they felt a little out of sorts, like they didn't really belong here on Earth, a little alienated, so to speak. In talking to them, at one point was hypnotized in a hotel room trying to recover the memory of my own alien abduction, but I totally failed at it. I couldn't quite picture what happened. But that doesn't actually prove that I wasn't abducted, because you see, that's how they work. You know, they're able to erase the memory of the abduction, so it doesn't prove anything.
Michael, how do you see all this? Does it relate to religion in some way?
Joel, they don't have three fingers, they have four. So just make a correction there. Actually, on Wednesday, I was on a TV show, just a Southern California TV show, which is where I'm from. And by the way, parenthetically, Virginia is not the hotbed of weirdness. Southern California is. You guys have nothing on us. We own that category. Anyway, the show was ostensibly on psychics and haunted houses, that sort of thing. But while I was waiting in the green room, there was a couple of women astrologers there talking about crop circles. And I said, well, you know, what do you think they are? And she said, well, you know, the aliens have, you know, left these circles in these crops. And I launched into this little routine I do that's actually usually pretty funny when I do it at Caltech for the skeptics. And it's like, you know, the chances of an extraterrestrial intelligence somehow mastering all the problems to conquer interstellar space travel and all the enormous technological advances they'd have to achieve to get here, and let alone even finding this obscure planet, what it would cost for them, and what are the chances they're going to do all that and just leave graffiti in Farmer Bob's field in Pucker Brush, Kansas? I mean, what is the likelihood of this? Then I do this whole thing about how, you know, we could just imagine, you know, at the planet Vega, and at the Senate hearings about about what actually happened here, about the crop circles and stuff. And, you know, so let me get this straight, Senator Zorg. You know, you spent 50 quazillion zlotys in order to find this planet, and the best you could do is leave graffiti, and the upheaval and the people that would be fired about this. And without missing a beat and not even blinking, this woman says, they don't use money on Vega. And honestly, she said, I wouldn't make this up. Some stuff I just make up, but this I didn't. And I said, I didn't know what to say. I said, you know, I just made that up. And she said, no. And the Pleiadians, they don't have government, and, you know, they're way beyond money and government and possessions. And,
you know, imagine no possessions. I did this whole thing. I wonder if you can. And she didn't get it, you know. She didn't just, you know. Anyway, so, and that's just a little sampling of what we do at Skeptic. We do try to take a pulse on this to try to keep track of this sort of thing. It is different from religion, certainly. Mainstream religions are not cults. You know, we need to use our language carefully. I think cult has become such a broadly used epithet in our culture. It's really meant to be an insulting sort of thing. And so I wouldn't call the U.S. Army and the Catholic Church and things like that cults. But when they're particularly centered on a single individual in which people are detached from their family members and reference groups, things like that, then it becomes cult-like, that sort of thing. And do I think this is actually somehow getting worse than it used to be? It's hard to say. From a social scientist, to answer the question properly, would need to operationally define what you mean by pseudoscience or superstitions or cults. Or you'd have to pick a particular subject. And then you need to define how you're going to measure the change. I mean, is it number of movies about cult-like or psychic phenomena like The Sixth Sense? Is it number of films, is it number of books, number of magazine articles, column inches in newspapers? And what's your time frame, 90s compared to the 80s, compared to the 60s, compared to 1900, compared to 1500? I suspect it's not as bad as it was, say, in 1500, if you were just talking about how superstitious the average guy in the street is. Hopefully, since we live in the age of science, we've made some progress. But it is surprising, since we live in the age of science, that 2/3 of Americans believe in psychic power, half believe in UFOs, the aliens are here, and that sort of thing. It is surprising, considering that we do live in such an advanced age.
Mm-hmm. And what's your take, Jody?
I think the biggest change since the 60s is media and technology. And that one of the things that has happened to us is that a lot of stories that might have been known only to small subgroups are now known to everybody. So what's interesting is not that Americans believe weird stuff. I mean, folks have always believed weird stuff. What's really interesting is why everybody else cares, right? Why does the Washington Post care about bizarre belief systems, right? And I think that the reason people care is that we're fascinated with those folks who are willing to doubt mainstream reality. And the reason we're fascinated by those folks willing to doubt mainstream reality is that most of us do. And the reason most of us do is it's so complicated now. Right? All of the technology makes it so complicated, and the stakes are very high. Right? One thing goes wrong with genetic engineering, and we're history. Right? One thing goes wrong with nuclear power, we're gone. So the stakes are very, very high. And to say that now science can save us, that strikes me as nuts, right? Science can go just as far the other way. So when we think about folks who believe in weird stuff, I think we're attracted to them because they're willing to take that step that most of us take in tiny little ways.
Alex, do you think that the people you met and interviewed were taking a step away from the technological drive of society?
Yeah, definitely. It's not just science. I talked about it. Most of these people are reacting against the way the world is right now. So it's a science, you know, big government, fairly liberal democracy, various aspects of the way current reality is, they just don't want any part of it. Either the world's too sinful, or sometimes it's people who are left out, too. A lot of the people, I have a lot of pseudoscientists in the book, and they think they are scientists, and they're not. They're crackpots. You know, they're people who are trying to invent perpetual motion machines or think that Space Brothers are landing next year at a precise day. It's because, you know, they're usually not people who had a chance to get a PhD. They either didn't have the money or they didn't have the intellect. But they still have these urges to do these things, and this is sort of their way of saying, I don't accept that science has all the answers and I can only consume it. I want to produce something. And so it's an active thing in that way.
Yeah, and it raises the question, too, of whether or not we can all agree that some things are real and some things are imaginary. I mean, do we get to the position where science is simply somebody's opinion, where facts are simply a prejudice? Joel, what's your take on that?
I think science is one of the great heroic feats of the human species in that, you know, I'm not a scientist, I'm a newspaper reporter, but, you know, people gave their lives to find out the truth about the world we live in. You know, the fact to be able to say that the Earth goes around the sun and not vice versa, you know, got Galileo and Giordano Bruno in a lot of trouble. You know, this is something that it kind of amazes me, actually, that so many people just sort of, I don't want to say seem unappreciative, but just sort of absorb all the technology and science that makes that enters our daily lives, takes it for granted, and then goes off and says, well, science is narrow-minded. I don't actually think science is narrow-minded. I think science has repeatedly given us some mind-boggling models of reality, ranging from, you know, the expanding universe. I mean, the whole universe is expanding. I mean, that's not something that necessarily is common sense.
Theme, story, the sci-fi story that gets inculcated into a dream state, a hallucination, triggered by the stress of physical exhaustion and mental exhaustion from sleep deprivation. Now, I don't claim abductees have been sleep deprived. I don't know what's going on with them. They had a bad pork chop the night before, or they're just fantasy prone. But when they tell you over and over and over that the abduction happened late at night at 3 a.m. when I was in my bed asleep, it seems like a more obvious hypothesis than abduction is sleep deprivation or a sleep hallucination or a lucid dream or something like that. And so, and in that case, I think, back to the what is science discussion, I think we can actually say in some instances whether things are true or not. And in any case, you certainly behaviorally act as if they're true or not. We make those decisions, even if intellectually we say, we qualify and say, well, maybe, perhaps, this kind of thing. Behaviorally, no one's an agnostic. And Sunday morning, you get up, tomorrow morning, you're either going to church or you're staying home to watch football or whatever's on. And so you make that decision. And for me, the decision is made that aliens are not coming here. They are not here. And I conceivably changed my mind, but I really need to see one of those, you know, probe instruments that they, you know, I just asked these guys, bring home an ashtray, something from the spacecraft. And they never do.
We have a few of those in the lobby afterwards.
Ashtrays or the probes?
Well, it depends on how you want to use an ashtray, I guess. Jody, Michael just mentioned the TV show The Invaders. And does anybody in here remember the TV show The Invaders? It's a great show, and one of the things it did was make you very, very paranoid that everybody around you was somehow, you know, an alien. To what extent does the alien phenomenon, do you think, intersect with our natural homegrown paranoia growing up out of the conspiracy to kill Kennedy and all the other conspiracies we've dealt with in the culture?
I think paranoia is part of being an American. The Declaration of Independence is a paranoid document, right? It has not, in addition to the wonderful preamble, right, the rest of it's a list of grievances that are designed to show that the king was involved in a conspiracy against the colonists. So since then, it's part of being an American, is to be paranoid. And now with cameras everywhere, I mean, even in this room, how are we not to be a little bit paranoid? I actually wanted to address Michael and Joel's point. I think a lot of abductees would like the kind of certainty of reality that Michael describes. And in fact, I think that abductees are a lot more skeptical than either one of them think that they are, and I probably think that they're more skeptical than they are. If Carl Sagan is the hero of Joel's book, I guess Bud Hopkins is probably the hero of mine. He's an abduction researcher and an artist in New York. And he has a wonderful little saying that he's more skeptical than Carl Sagan because he's willing to question everyday reality. And that's one of the things that I found in my research with abductees is that they don't believe anything for sure. They're not 100% convinced about UFOs or aliens or what they've been through. All they know is that they've experienced something that they absolutely can't explain and that they can't understand and that they're not getting very much support for. So I think it's important to think about, you know, what does it actually mean to be skeptical and how far can one go? Because I think that most abductees go really, really far, and in their willingness to question everyday reality, they go a lot further than, you know, some so-called skeptics.
And Alex, just to pick up on this note of skepticism and believing, to what extent do you think the people really are skeptical, and to what extent do you think they're enabled by great scientists, perhaps someone like John Mack?
Wait, which people?
People who've been abducted by aliens. I mean, do they really examine this, or are some of these events repressed memories or planted?
I don't know much about abductees nearly as much as these guys, so I shouldn't wander down that path. But I do think, just talking about skepticism, One of the things about these beliefs is it's not a choice with most people. It's just there. And I often come to a point where I try to explain why somebody believes something. And you can't ultimately explain it, and they can't either, because if you ask them, you know, why do you believe this? And you're asking them to step aside and look at themselves as a specimen, you know. And they go, well, it's not a belief, it's the truth. And so it's not something they can do anything about, and most of them are, you know, pursue these beliefs without hurting anyone. There are major exceptions to that. And what I like in a skeptic, Shermer here, is operates the way I think they should. He reads their material. He says, I disagree with all of this, and here are my counter arguments. There's a strain of skepticism, though, that goes farther than that, almost puritanically saying, it is bad by definition that anybody believes these things, and we have to figure out something to do about it beyond providing counter arguments. And, you know, we don't do that in this country. We don't have a police state saying you can't believe these things. But there are places where it is like that. And I defend people's right to have goofball ideas, you know.
Speaking of condemning people's ideas and all the rest, which sounds like almost a reactionary Christian sort of thing, perhaps not to diss the Christians too much, because they were once there themselves. But how much of this is an interface between superstition and religion?
Well, I'm not sure I can address that in great depth. I mean, in fact, in reporting this book, felt kind of challenged in my inability to really appreciate the origins of religion, the origins of belief. I realized when I went into this book, I wanted to find out, well, what is the truth about life beyond Earth? I mean, my book is actually, I mean, two-thirds of it is about what you'd say is science. It's about the space program. It's about the SETI search for radio signals. Only the middle part is the UFO stuff. And I, in fact, kind of, you know, go down that road and then throw up my hands and say, there's no information here. I mean, the bad thing about the aliens that come and abduct people is they don't actually tell you anything about themselves. The aliens have no information. They have no history. I mean, it'd be so great if they would say, well, here's the last 1,000 years of history of our civilization in the Pleiades, but they don't give that. I mean, they're very mysterious, slippery creatures who just take little, you know, segments of your DNA and then run away, you know, and it's... So as far as trying to find the truth about life beyond Earth, I find that the UFO hypothesis has a deficit of information and is fundamentally not that interesting. I mean, you know, the problem with that whole scenario, in my opinion, is that it's not true. I mean, the aliens are not here. That is my take on it. Now, I'm just a newspaper reporter, so no one should believe what I say about that. But for me, trying to find out, you know, what is the biology of the universe? I mean, we're in this amazing moment right now in which, thanks to these incredible telescopes we have, we know, or we have the information to believe that we live in this unbelievably huge universe in which the Earth is a tiny little world. I mean, just one little planet around one star that's maybe among 100 billion stars in one galaxy among 50 billion galaxies. So this sort of challenges us to figure out, you know, what's going on here? What does that mean? And we know the structure of that universe fairly well. I mean, we have all this data coming in about what's out there structurally, the physics of the universe. What do we know about the biology of the universe? What do we know about life beyond Earth? And the truth is, we don't really know anything at all. Right now, we don't have any information about a single microbe from beyond this planet, except for the assertion by this one team of NASA scientists that they found some microbes in that meteorite from Mars. That claim, as I show in the book, is very questionable. Most people in that field, you know, who are fellow meteoriticists, people who study this stuff, say they don't got the goods on that claim. We don't, at the moment, know of any liquid water beyond this planet. So before we find, you know, intelligent aliens, and before we find even a microbe of life out there, it'd be nice to find some liquid water. So that's where we're at right now. And to me, it's sort of an amazing puzzle, because we may be in this sort of special moment in human history before the discovery of of the truth about the biology of the universe. Unfortunately, you know, you can go to scientists and try to get information, and it's like, you know, it can be really difficult to get any real facts out of them. But definitely in the UFO world, you find it even harder to find anything that you could really say, this feels like the truth.
Michael, from the UFO believers' point of view, or the experiencers, as they call themselves, there are certain things that are central to their beliefs, the missing time, as you mentioned, the lonely Nebraska highway. Are there any pieties that are particular to the scientific mindset or to being a skeptic, to the skeptical mindset, that are themselves questionable, possibly?
Nope.
I'm glad we cleared this up.
We have certainty. Well, now look, this is the core of the debate here that Jody has identified, and I think the terms of the debate, this side and that side. There's an essential tension in science that exists in all of us, that tension between orthodoxy and change, between being open-minded enough to accept radical new ideas, but not so open-minded that your brains fall out. And where do you draw that line? How do I know? I mean, I don't want to be a grumpy old skeptic that misses out on the great new discovery of the 21st century. I don't want to be that guy. But so much of what I encounter is just utter bunk that it seems to pay to be conservative. And science really is conservative in that regard. It can't afford not to be. There's only so much time and resources and money to run around exploring and testing a lot of these claims. My buddies at Caltech, they don't have time to deal with all these perpetual motion machines and free energy people. They just have them call me. And essentially, that's what we do at Skeptic, is we do that. But there are not that many people doing that. And most mainstream scientists don't want to be bothered. So they come off as real elitists and snobs and closed-minded. And you're just not open. They're plenty open-minded about all kinds of things. And science is very open to radical new ideas. Witness all the revolutions that have occurred in the history of science. But in the alien example, I think, and Sagan is such a good example of somebody who treaded that fine line, that tension between being fairly open-minded, and when he first started off, he was pretty radical. I mean, it really hurt him. He couldn't get tenure at Harvard. He never got elected to the National Academy of Science, and those probably because he stepped over that boundary. But he never steps too far beyond that boundary. He would not go so far as to accept the alien abduction scenarios and UFOs is actually proof of people visiting here, yet he was speculating on Phobos as an artificial satellite, these sorts of things, which got him in plenty of trouble with the more conservative establishment. So there's no answer to the question in you and me and each of us when we think about any given claim, where am I going to fall on that line? It's a tough call. And I think we do decide. I think all these guys decide. Hopkins, Mack, me, we all have decided. And I think it'd be disingenuous to pretend otherwise, that I'm just open-minded. I don't think I'm really open-minded on the subject. I don't think Hopkins or Mack is either. They'll say that in an interview on television because it sounds good. Oh, I'm open-minded. I'm not sure what it is. You know, could be this, could be that. Yeah, but really, really, they've decided. They don't accept my scenario that it's a psychosocial phenomenon or brain hallucination. They really don't accept that. They really think something else is going on. And I think I've decided it isn't. And I think if we're going to be honest with ourselves, we do make a decision at some point, and then we go down that road. And it's hard to back off, particularly when you write a book about it or something. It's really hard to back off.
We're hearing some names here that maybe not everybody's familiar with. Can you tell us a little bit, Jody, about John Mack and Bud Hopkins?
Sure. John Mack, as I've mentioned, is a professor at Harvard. He's a Pulitzer Prize winner for a biography of Lawrence of Arabia. And he has two books. The most recent is Passport to the Cosmos. And in that one, he's making connections between the abduction experience and shamanism all over the world. This was a huge study that he received funding for, to go and talk to a shaman in the rainforest and in various different countries. And his other book, I think it's just called Abduction, is a series of case studies of his work with abductees. Bud Hopkins is, for many people credit Bud Hopkins with really getting the abduction issue out in front of the mainstream public, along with Whitley Strieber. And Hopkins has a number of books where he describes his research on abduction and his work with specific abductees. And he has a Intruders Foundation in New York that has
to, you know, the existence of dinosaurs, you know, that millions of years ago these giant reptiles were pounding around the planet. I mean, that is an amazing idea. You know, tectonic drift. I mean, the fact that that entire continents can float on the surface of the planet and move around is, again, it's a very challenging idea that has been borne out over time. And so it kind of bums me out that people think science is this sort of narrow view of reality, when I look at science as being the kind of combined effort of thousands and thousands of men and women over a very long period of time trying to find out, well, what is the sort of reality behind the world as we perceive it?
Michael, is it becoming simply a matter of faith over proof?
Well, I'm a pretty pro-science guy, so I concur with Joel on a lot of that. On the other hand, the examples that you gave were where the demarcations are pretty clear between what's sense and nonsense. And we've got confirmation and almost total agreement amongst most scientists on a lot of these things. When you get into the social sciences, it's a lot fuzzier, and those fuzzy sets have big fuzzy boundaries between the sense and the nonsense, and it's harder to say, you know. So a lot of issues of Skeptic magazine we devote to these social issues because that's where the action is for me. It's not clear. We did a whole issue on race and IQ when the bell curve came out. Boy, you talk about lack of agreement and egos and people getting upset. The data do not just speak for themselves. They are definitely filtered through theories, and particularly in the social sciences, science is very much theory-driven. And so we have to be cautious about some of those social claims. And of course, even in biology, where we know evolution's a fact, it's not in Kansas. And some other places in America, and it's really definitely an American phenomenon that evolution is even challenged. Nowhere else in the world, except a little pocket in Australia, do people even doubt that evolution happened. They may argue about how it happened, and punctuated equilibrium and gradualism, these sorts of things, but that tells us that there's a cultural element there involved in science. And as for faith, how we believe, I really make the argument that these are two separate things, reason and faith, or science and religion, mainly because the problem, if you're religious, with trying to prove your tenets of faith is that you're always chasing science. You're always one step behind, wondering where it's going. And what did they discover today? Oh, no, they found another black hole. Oh, dear. Now, let's see. This is not in Genesis. Now, how am I going to reconcile this with my religion? You know, if you're constantly thinking, I got to somehow prove that my religion is true, then you're going to be stuck with the ever-changing nature of science and having to change your religious tenets to go along with that. And I think that's the biggest argument from the religious side for why you shouldn't be trying to do science when it's really just religion.
Jody, do you think that some of the scientific certainties that we hold very closely now in 100, 200 years might look like bloodletting to people of the future?
I actually think that there are scientific things that we think we're certain about that we're actually not. For example, salt. I don't know if anybody remembers, but about 2 years ago, I think it was Scientific American, came out with all the debate about salt. Health people and medical scientists disagree about whether salt is bad for us or not. If people follow diets as they're given to the American public, there's a big debate about whether or not you should eat a lot of protein or eat a lot of carbohydrates. I mean, these are things that we're taught are basic science that the scientists seem to know. But then once you start digging a little bit, we realize that there's major disagreement. So how mad cow disease is transmitted, that's not clear. There's a huge debate about that. So I actually think that it's important to remember that what seems to be a clear-cut set of facts is not clear-cut at all. The other thing I want to add is that it's weird how people who want to give a strong defense of science against, you know, pseudoscience want to say, oh, science has amazing ideas and is, you know, not just common sense. But then they turn around and say, oh, those UFO people, they don't have common sense and they've got American ideas. I mean, not American, I'm sorry, they've got amazing wild ideas. So I start to worry that no matter how it's sliced, the people who are doing wild stuff always end up getting trashed, right? Either they've got too much common sense because science has amazing ideas, or they've got too amazing ideas because science has the monopoly on common sense. Finally, on whether or not people who do UFO stuff or so-called fringe stuff are really on the fringes, or whether or not they're really people who are left out, I got into this field because of Harvard professor John Mack's work, who, because he believes that the abductees are telling the truth. I was shocked that someone in the university of the country would go that far. So I'm not even sure enough to say that people with wild, so-called fringe ideas are really on the fringe at all.
Well, John Mack is certainly the unnamed elephant in the room in a lot of respects. Alex, let me ask you, you touched upon something earlier. How much of the how many of the millennial events do you think are a direct result of the assignment desk's obsession with them? Would people really care? Would it be the tree falling in the forest and nobody would really bother?
No, I think there's steady interest, but they didn't care. I used to write about this stuff in the late 80s, and I had trouble selling my story ideas because people would say, that's fascinating, but what's the hook? And there isn't a hook. The fact that there are people, Christians who believe the world will end as described in Revelation, there's not always a clear reason to get into it. So, but I do think, we definitely had a surge of interest. The other thing I noticed, I got a lot of calls from TV reporters who are the laziest people in the world. And they were like, we got to do a piece on millennial groups. Can you give me five names? And I want people who are like bunkering down. they're probably going to kill themselves. And so there's always this assumption that it's dangerous, negative, that the year 2000 and the midnight on January 1st was a major flashpoint. Mm-hmm. All that can be true, but it's usually not true. And I kept saying, most of these people, when their thing doesn't happen, they've already built in a clause to their beliefs that will allow them to go on. Now with Y2K, that was impossible. It's one of the few times, but with Earth changes, which is a very widespread belief that the planet is trying to kill us by producing more natural disasters, they used to talk about 98 as being the trigger year when you could not mistake that this was happening. And then it was a bad weather year, but it wasn't like they thought. So they switched and said, the spirits say that 2012, we've been given an extension.
Kind of like a great student loan program.
Yeah.
Joel, speaking of escape clauses, you mentioned Carl Sagan shifting his frontier further and further away. For example, the moon around Mars being possibly a man-made construct. What was your experience with the escape clause phenomenon?
Well, Sagan said at one point in the 60s, and for many years he entertained the idea that Phobos, one of the moons of Mars, might be a hollow object. That is, a construction of some intelligent civilization. And Sagan is sort of the hero of my book because he entertains these wild ideas. But he has the ability at the last minute to sort of pull back and say, but what do we really know? And he was willing, up until really his deathbed, to say that even though he had spent his whole life trying to find extraterrestrial life, even though he wanted to know the truth about life beyond Earth, he knew that he had not found it. It takes a lot of courage to say, I don't know, in a situation like this, because typically in this topic, the alien topic, people say, oh, I know. I know exactly what the reality is. And they try to prove it to you. What Jody said before, I want to address that about, are scientists good and UFO true believers bad? You weren't making it that simple, but I try to show in my book that scientists are just, in many ways, very much like everyone else in that they have belief systems that they pursue, and sometimes it colors the way they view the world. I mean, Sagan thought there were 1 million civilizations in this galaxy at this moment, 1 million other intelligent civilizations. And that he had no data to support that. I mean, he had an estimate that he made based on this thing called the Drake equation. But you find, in fact, throughout the scientific world, a lot of very wild ideas that are not necessarily true. In fact, in my book, there's a chapter on Charlottesville, because I came here for a meeting of the Society for Scientific Exploration, where all kinds of, you know, unusual ideas about, you know, past life recall and near-death experiences are entertained. And so I try to show that it's not like, you know, there's a divide between, you know, the hard scientists and then the, you know, the soft-minded cultural believers.
Excuse me, Michael. One thing I'm curious about is this whole fuzzy zone, the shift between knowing something and being skeptical. And in the past, we might be skeptical in order to drive ourselves toward knowing something really, really well. Do you find that there's no room for skepticism among certain believers? And do you find yourself a very unwelcome guest in a lot of venues?
Yes.
Moving on.
Let me just tell you a little story, actually, I recount in Why People Believe Weird Things, and that is in August of 1983, I was abducted by aliens. It's true. It actually happened, or something happened. And so the story goes like this, and this, I'm not making this up either. I was traveling down a lonely rural highway in Nebraska, and isn't that always where these things happen, lonely rural highways? But I was, and it was about 3 a.m., and a large craft with bright lights came up over my left shoulder and stopped me, and you know, they took me into the craft where I lost 90 minutes of time. Abductees call this missing time. They write books about missing time. And the next thing I knew, I was like out of the craft and traveling back down the road, and I distinctly remember the aliens, what they looked like. They looked just like people. In fact, they looked just like people that I knew. But I knew that they were aliens because they had stiff little fingers. And I could see that. And that was my clue that I knew that they knew. But they didn't know that I knew that they were aliens. So I was going along with this whole thing, knowing that I knew, but that they didn't know. And this went on and on. Anyway, and I used to tell this story when I was teaching a psych course on, when I get to the part on schizophrenia, where schizophrenics hear voices. You know, they really hear the voices. The experiences are very real for them. And so I will tell that story because it's a very real experience for me. Now I tell the story in the context of aliens, because when I was telling the story back in the early 80s, the stuff wasn't big. Now it's huge, and everybody's being abducted by aliens. In my case, the explanation is that traveling down the lonely rural highway, I was actually on a bicycle, in the middle of a transcontinental bike race called Race Across America that I founded and raced in a number of times. And the race has rules in which you don't stop. It's from West Coast to East Coast. First one there wins. Everybody takes the same route. And so there's no sleep. Or you can sleep if you want, but then you fall behind. So I had gone 83 hours without sleep and ridden 1,250 miles without stopping, except for a few potty breaks in the motorhome that always follows behind you at night with bright white lights with a support crew that looks just like people you know. And over the years, I've done informal studies with the various riders, and when I quit riding, racing the race, and I'd still go along and study the sleep patterns of the riders, and everybody was hallucinating like crazy in the early years because they didn't figure out the sleep pattern stuff. So the 90 minutes of missing time, by the way, I was weaving down the road at about 5 miles an hour, hallucinating away, and my crew stopped me and put me in for a 90-minute sleep break, which is a nice cycle because you can get down to the deep and back up to the light sleep and then back going again, and you'd be amazed what you can do in 90 minutes of sleep. But that's the missing time. And the stiff little finger is where it's really the crux of the story is that when I was a kid, there was a story, a TV show on CBS starring Roy Thinnes. I just saw him on X-Files a few months ago, in fact. Yeah. And the aliens were taking over the planet, and they looked just like humans. And again, one of these stories, you know, somehow they've mastered interstellar space travel, and they could take over DNA and replicate somebody's body, but they couldn't bend their fingers. Anyway, so they had to wear gloves and go through all these contrivances so that people wouldn't notice the stiff little fingers, but I noticed. So there, how odd that, you know, 20 years after the fact, deep in the recesses of my memory, comes this television